Hello, everybody. It's your old friend Arthur Nerdalos, and welcome back to the final episode of the season of Future Wrestling.
I never thought we'd see the end of season three, I'm not going to lie.
Neither did I, considering this is season two.
Oh my god, is this season two?
Good night, everybody.
That was so perfect. Can we just call it there, people, please?
Yeah. That's gone on the blooper reel.
Yeah.
Oh my god, it's gone on for fucking years.
That's all
they need to get. Yeah, 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 I was thinking that, alright, this one's gone on a bit longer than season one, and I know I missed, like, the first bit of season one, mind, but...
Mm. Oh, yeah, no, this is a substantially longer season than that. And here we are, we've all lived to tell the tale. Either way, that's...
We're all
this
alcoholics now.
Yeah. Well, yeah. What, mean now?
We're all now admitting to be alcoholics now.
Okay, that's more like it, yeah. That's far more accurate.
Nothing, I'm drinking water.
No,
I'd Russian water, maybe.
I made a gin.
That's fair. In any case, as I said, our season finale is our next destination to see if indeed Future Wrestling is gone for good or not. We shall we'll have to tune in to find out there.
Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last. And we've been renewed for a new season. Oh, crap.
Free of our contractual obligations. Oh, shit.
Woo! I get to work somewhere else. Oh, my God. This is going to be so exciting. Oh, no, do you not know? No, they renewed your contract. Oh, okay.
Oh, shit.
Really, did they? Well, we'll see about that.
I'll talk to my agents.
They're on my list of enemies now. You think I'm joking? I'm not joking. You're on my list of enemies.
I genuinely cannot go.
You just make the list. The list.
Totally joking.
Anyway,
That's still the most heartbreaking thing ever. Was when Jericho's like, "Why is my name on this?" You're just like, ah! Actually, I honestly, God, I remember looking at it. I think someone had it like on a video on YouTube, and it was just like, "Wait, why is my name on the list?" And it was just like, oh. I actually legit felt bad for Jericho.
I know.
Like, ew.
It goes better with the Titanic music.
Oh my god! Actually, I forgot about that. Shit. I need to find that again.
Right.
I definitely only have a match, yeah? We're good.
Yeah, you work away. Let's introduce the room, shall we? So on the top left here, currently doing a Countdown Conundrum, apparently going by the whiteboard, is Foxy, who doing a cracking Where's Wally impression this week. Foxy, you're again playing double duty this week, the two sides of the Youngblood story, it seems. But the match seems to be made between you two for Downfall, night two at least. Looks like this is getting settled one way or another.
Yeah, like it seems to be coming to a head, and it will take place at the pay-per-view or a premium live event, whichever you want to go with. But
pay-per-view is fine.
Yeah, pay-per-view is a lot better. It's easier to say. But yeah, like the tension is really building up, and both of them are really showing that their distaste for each other, and whatever happens in this go home, I don't know. We'll have to wait and see.
Indeed, we will. On the top right then is Alan Morph, who after having a wonderful, happy couple of weeks, to be curtailed suddenly by the return of One Way and Kyle, who. Seems taking quite a umbrage at you in particular, still being on the show, Alan Morph. Do you know anything about that?
I take umbrage with that cunt existing. Like, you know.
And whisper, never... but a lot of people feel the same way.
This is a family show.
Okay, I take the Dolores umbrage with that person that I do not like existing. You happy Grandpa Fox?
Hey, just say cunt.
Captain America.
He's a
oh, if you're Captain America, does that make me Falcon?
I don't like Captain America.
Hey! The new Captain
America. Hey! Hold on a second. Why don't you like Captain America?
I'm very much... Oh, no, it's not that I don't like Captain America. It's just I'm always going to be Team Iron Man.
Look.
That sound you're hearing is Aaron's nerd rage.
Both of them are wrong.
Both over there. Like, it sounds like a kettle, doesn't it? Sounds like a kettle.
Both of them. Why the both of us wrong?
Don't make Joe makes it even better now that this is just going to fester in him for like the rest of this entire recording. And does Aaron have a promo tonight?
He doesn't.
No, I don't.
No, does he have a match?
He does have a match. Does he have,
so he does actually have a reason to be here. Okay, Grant.
Ouch. Ding. Come on, he was bobbing for a couple of weeks. He did pretty well there. You know, come on.
Yeah, I nearly beat you, but I apparently couldn't cop the fucking cues to Chief for 1 week.
There you go. That's what happens. That's what happens if you don't take when you don't take a simple prop, Darren. You become bobbing. Anyway, on the left hand side is Amy playing Casey Colt, and again with the very much your situation for downfall is quite clear. You are going to be fighting on the network's behalf in the fight for control or survival, whichever way it works. So naturally, not a popular decision amongst some of your peers. But how's Casey Cole feeling going into this match? Is she confident on leading her team to victory?
A little bit numb, despondent. Mm-hmm. She's probably drunk, to be honest with you, at this point.
I mean, I think a lot of people are on the beach at this stage. It's been a very, very long season for a lot of people. So
let's call it spade a spade, okay? Casey Cole checked out a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
He is kind of just going through the motions.
Yeah.
Kind of like me. While I look for the Festival of Friendship Titanic cut. So, I mean...
Art imitates life so much on this channel, doesn't it? On the right-hand side then is Aaron playing Mr. Jimmy Morris. Again, your match was made for downfall as well. On the first night, you'll be faced against the Rose family with a very tantalizing hope that the Rose family will be dissolved once and for all. But you might have to risk your own career to do so. How are you feeling about that, Aaron? And are you worried that the body of work that you have built up over the decades as Jimmy Morris will all end up being nothing?
No, because it's the Rose family. And let's be honest, anyone can beat them. Even though I have losses against Jack Freedom.
It's fine. It's fine. You're confident. What you're saying, you're confident going into the match.
Yes. Yes. Confident. That's good. I don't know what confidence feels like, but I suppose I have it.
Technically speaking, that's a start.
After last week's train wreck of a promo is what I need to make up for this week by winning emphatically.
Good,
because I'd like to forget that last week happened, to be honest. Because I was thinking back over it after when I was done, and I was like, oh my god, you.
So do we, mate. We had to sit through the whole goddamn thing.
It was so bad.
Again, I choose to believe the that was genuinely the promo that Jimmy Morris said in the ring, and just everyone just had to kind of sit there awkwardly waiting for the prompt. I think just like, yeah, that's actually quite on brand. in the center screen then is the current future world champion, Violet Storm, who, again, very evidently is facing James Rage at the pay-per-view, the potentially last match of future wrestling. Hotly anticipated, it has to be said. How are you feeling going into this match?
Right.
Yeah. I love that smile. I will never get to get that smile. But obviously, you also had another curveball challenger last week where it seems like you're going to be defending the title twice at Downfall. On night one, you're defending against Cyrus Gold, who has rather skipped the queue, much to everyone's dismay, it seems. That's not going to go well for Cyrus Gold, I assume, because you want to have this match with James Rage just as much as he does.
Absolutely, we're going to have a barn burner. But yeah, I'm not surprised that a curveball has been thrown and that it's Cyrus and not somebody else who has been, like, you know, on every single show day in, day out. But sure, you know, politics.
Who's been here every goddamn day?
Any of you lot?
All of us, yeah.
You have been here more than Cyrus.
Yeah.
Oh my god, I've really fucking checked out. I thought I was taking the piss. Maybe the gin was a bad idea.
Maybe it was.
Nah.
I was gonna realize like an hour in, she's still on the Zoom call. I was like, oh shit. On the
mind it. This is actually really upsetting me.
Yeah. In any case, finally, we have Dave playing the Wraith, who was again made a return, if you will.
Who?
You say this every week. I've not been involved in shows in like 6 or 7 weeks. This is really annoying. Can I please be booked on the card?
Amy has meanies. Can you just hold on there? We need to see what's happening with the meanies. Sorry, Dave. We'll get back to you in a minute. It's fine. Yeah, she got meanies. There we go. There we go.
Right, okay.
Sorry, Dave. You're there. You got your meanies. You're not booked again, are you not?
Got your meanies there, you wanker. Anyway.
Yeah.
Bottom
My mouth
is
salivating.
That's what she said. The bottom line is... Yeah. I've not been booked for 6 or 7 weeks. I'm here every week. It's bullshit. I need booked.
You need money?
Anyway, I've got kids. I'll be it furry ones, but they're still children.
Two little kittens. Kittens count as kids. It's fine. Sorry.
Look, tell it to her face. She needs shoes.
I would give anything to see your cats wearing fucking little booties. That would be the cutest goddamn thing.
He's staring at the camera. She's like, are these people going to feed me?
She actually is really annoyed that you're not being booked, actually. I've never been stared out of it by a cat before, but fucking hell. This is slightly unnerving, I'll be honest.
You've never been stared out of it by a pussy?
Yay.
No, I didn't say that in particular.
You are
I didn't
lazy,
say that in particular.
Man. Lazy.
I said cats. It's a critical difference.
Oh, case, you roll a 12 every time you go down? Oh!
Oh! Anyway, so we will also have James raging at some stage tonight, but we are going to continue on with our show as best we can until we get to the main event. So we get our opening titles as ever, and Mike Dublin welcomes us to ringside and gives us a rundown of the action from the last couple of weeks and a reminder of how the match cards for both nights are panning out. But as he does that, then he also draws attention to something that happened before the broadcast started. Well, obviously, folks, it has been a particularly tumultuous time here in Future Wrestling, especially with what's happened with Rob Midas and even before then with the previous iterations of the general manager's office. But it seems that Fred Rose has added another extra element to this as he released this on our social media earlier today. But we're going to play it to you now to provide you the context of what happens next tonight. So we do that, and we get basically a shot of Federal sitting at the general manager desk going, you know, I don't know what it is about this room or this office that makes it feel so irrelevant, but either way, it doesn't really matter tonight. But nevertheless, tonight is a very special episode of Future Wrestling because, after all, the curtain closes on this particular carnival tonight. The final episode, the true final TV episode of Future Wrestling is tonight. What a wonderful occasion for all of us here at the show, particularly those who stand to profit remarkably from its departure. But the reason I'm standing here in this particular office and not one Robert Midas is because I raised a very valid point of order with the VCR network, that because Rob Midas is involved in this fight for struggle, for power, if you will, for Future Wrestling, that he is very much perjured in regards to his bias against people on my team. Indeed, I find it quite astounding that he's not just simply put everyone in handicap matches or extreme rules matches or whatever you people call them every single week just to soften them up. What a sporting old fellow he is. Unfortunately, I'm not as sporting as he is, and I very much like to play dirty when I get an opportunity, which is why I'm sitting here and not Rob Midas, and certainly not Kyle Dekker. Tonight, I am the general manager of this show for 1 week only, because 1 week is all I need to ensure that I win at Downfall. In fact, I want to make this one simple rule. Rob Midas, you're in action tonight against Cutter. And it's not going to go any way but unsuccessfully for you. In fact, you're going to gloriously fail in that ring because Cutter Jones is going to tear you limb from limb. And if anyone else wants to know, that is the theme of tonight. Anyone who sees themselves as a rebel, as fighting for the flag of Future Wrestling, are all going down in flames tonight. And it starts with you, Mr. Midas. In fact, I've also signed another match for tonight's main event. The Emperors, who are indeed a team, are going to go up against two people who are not. Violet Storm and James Rage, yes, you were promised a night off, but not anymore. You're teaming up tonight. let's see if you can sit on the same page. I have absolutely no intention of ensuring you will. But for now, oh, and one last thing to Carl Decker. I believe there was someone rather ethereal looking for your attention last week. Why don't we give him what he wants, eh? Carl Decker versus the Wraith. Also on the show tonight. I promise it'll be a big show for our last one, and I always keep my promises in the same way I keep my promise that I'm going to take control of future wrestling and crush it in this hand. Enjoy your show, ladies and gentlemen, because it's the last one. Make it worth your while. And it fades to black on that. So, as we basically fade from that, then we're going to roll into our first match. So obviously we have the promo from Fred Rose there, and we're going to cut straight then to the entrance of Rob Midas, and we got a ring announcer from there going, ladies and gentlemen, this opening contest is scheduled for one fall.
One fall.
Introducing to the ring first, weighing in at 221 pounds, he is the general manager of Future Wrestling, Rob Midas. Well, I think the look on his face there really says it all, ladies and gentlemen. He is not a happy man tonight, and can you really blame him in that sense? This situation with Fred Rose is only getting worse by the day, and considering this is the last episode of the show and Fred Rose is in control of it, and he is certainly going to try and make it as much about him as possible. That much is for certain. For Rob Midas, any challenge that he has going to the downfall is going to take a massive asterisk, because he has to get through tonight first against the gargantuan that is Cutter Jones. So that fades to black, and we get Cutter's entrance from there. And his opponent, weighing in at 381 pounds from parts unknown, Connor!
What's your voice?
I have like a weird kind of thing, not from my throat rate lately. So when I try and hit a certain note, it just goes, it's like, it's really weird. I can't get rid of it.
Oh my god, yeah, you guys.
It's so weird. Like, I can't get it. It's like I have a sore throat, but it's taking like a week to heal. It's very strange.
I can't.
Yeah, I don't know. Anyway. So Cutter makes his way down to the entrance. Obviously, he's delighted with life. He's kind of rubbing his hands, thinking like, oh, he's finally got kind of Rob Midas in the match here. So he's gonna take his time to the ring. Rob Midas obviously in his kind of insert thing with gear and, you know, shit himself, as you would expect. So he's coming down to the ring, taking his time, throwing the ring, all that sort of stuff, and he finally enters on death. And we get the bell ringing from there. So obviously, Dennis and Gary can't join us tonight, so we're going to NPC this match. So we're going to go around the houses and see who we want to win. So, Foxy, you go first.
Midas.
Okay, we've got two from Midas here. Casey?
Midas.
Kira?
Midas.
Dave?
Midas, Cutter's a unionist.
And Aaron is not here. So we looked at, we have a walkover from Midas, it seems. So we'll work off the match that way. So it'll take a kind of very familiar pattern of obviously Cutter being the bigger of the two, getting the power advantage and using it to great avail. He's kind of toying with Midas essentially throughout the entire match. So again, if you all have spots, feel free to shout them out. We can add them into the match. But
Jonathan, can I start? What's Cutter's finisher?
He tends to go for, he has the Armageddon, so that's the kind of the inverted fisherman's buster, isn't it?
Yeah, he also has the Katahajime.
The Katahajime as well, yeah, so he has those two.
Oh, have him go for the Katahajime, is that the chokeout submission?
Yeah,
the submission, yeah.
Have him go for that, but like, just when the ref goes to check, he just lets go the hold, like, and he kind of starts time with Midas, and Midas kind of just comes back then, like, over time.
Yeah, so that's a fair shout. So yeah, with Cutter kind of like toying away, thinking he's got this under control. So like, we have Midas kind of firing up and trying to stay in the match. And obviously, that gets a crowd going, cheering for him and so forth. But like I said, the power advantage continues on basically until we get to a stage where like Cutter goes, he kind of checks his watch and goes, okay, that's enough fun, and he starts going for his Armageddon. So remarkably, what's going to happen is that as he's going to go for it, there's going to be a bit of a fumble. Rob Midas is going to hook him in for a small package. And we get a very quick trick count from there. One, two, three, ring the bell. Ladies and gentlemen, your winner of this contest, Rob Midas. So obviously Midas tries to get away, but Cutter, quick as anything, just goes, nah, fuck this. And he grabs Rob Midas by the leg and essentially goes like, no, not as easy as that. So he drags drags Rob Midas out to the outside, and essentially he's going to choke Rob Midas through the announcer's table. This would all make sense, a downfall. But he will choke bomb Rob Midas through the table, and we basically get the commercial, the commentators taking over from there. I don't think Cutter took too kindly to losing that match against Rob Midas. He expected this to be a walkover, and for the first few minutes it certainly was, but Rob Midas showing that he does have a lot more fight in him than it comes across. But as I'm talking to you now, Rob Midas is thrown across the remnants of this announcer's table, and he's not looking too good. Obviously, we have medical officials on the way to assist the stricken Rob Midas, but it's not looking good here for him at the moment. And it's a troubling situation. We have to cut the commercial, folks. We'll try and give you an update on Rob Midas when we come back from the commercial. We'll see you then. So obviously, Cutter's very happy with himself at that point, and we get faded black from there. Okay, so when we come back, then we obviously see. Kind of Rob Midas being helped out to the back, and we cut then to backstage, where it looks like Wayne Kyle is kind of barking out orders. So he's got a kind of like a headset, he's got a phone, he's on the phone, he's kind of like, you know, just finishing a phone call basically, until he goes, he kind of motions to someone back off camera, going, hey, you, what's your name? Intern, come over here for a second,
intern.
Okay. Right, I need you to do something very, very simple for me, okay? Double coffee, straight to my desk, okay? It's the one right beside the general manager's office, okay? Do you need directions? Do you know where you're going?
Oui, coffee for Midas, yes, I understand.
No, coffee for me. Midas is gone. Midas is gone for the night, okay? Don't worry about him. Double coffee. Double shot for me, all right?
So, very strong tea with milk for Midas.
No milk. Close. No tea.
I get close.
Coffee. C-O-F-F-E-E. Do I have to spell it out to you? Bring it down to my office right beside the general manager's, which is Fred Rose's. Understand?
Baby says, so you want the rose syrup, coffee, double espresso from Midas.
No. Do you know what? Forget about it. Forget I asked. I'll do it myself. Just go. Get out of here. Hey, come here. Intern.
What can I do for you, mate? What can I do you?
That accent sounds familiar. Look, do you have any idea if James Rage and Violet Summer are in the building yet?
Hey, have you seen them come in the car, like?
It's not coming here, right?
I was going to take a look under it, maybe fit something to it, but they weren't too keen on that, you know.
No, you're fine, thanks.
Are you sure? I could do it for the very good price, like £300, maybe £400, you know. It's a good deal.
I get the feeling you're not an intern. Do you not forget
no,
about
no,
it?
No, I'll tell you what, I'll do your deal, 2 for 1. You know, just give me the registration.
No, just get out of here, just go, just leave, just leave, just get out of here. Just go.
Interns! What? It's been too long. Interns, assemble!
What the hell are you doing?
Can you see the one? He's on your left.
This is fucking terrifying.
This is war, gentlemen. War, absolute war. Come one, come all. One side will meet its downfall. And as we stand on the cups of victory, it does not matter who lives, who dies, who tells our story. We will not go down as minions. We will go down as interns.
Fucking minions rip off, so it is.
Then the intern just turns, looks fucking Wayne in the eye. All the chaos that you want, this little bit of hatred you got. If he actually picks up the coffee that he actually got from the property, leaves it on the table, I'm not so sure it can be contained in that ring. And then it just leaves.
I adore that we have Lin-Manuel Miranda on our fucking writing staff. That's top notch fucking booking there.
Yeah, we had some budget. So what happened then when the interns kind of disperse, you know, like, can talk about munchkins. And when he does that, he goes, he lifts up the coffee cup. And then when he just like can lift it up and like he'll take a sip from it, and underneath it, it just says the word backyard. And it just fades to black from there. Well, I think Wayne Coyle is certainly feeling the pressure, but not necessarily from anything else in the VCR network, but from the interns who I think it's fair to say are on the side of the Future Wrestling Network. I mean, they are getting paid for them after all, but either way, it seems that... Well, one of them certainly wasn't, but
it's really fair... PR wrestler, sir.
Mm-hmm. But either way, the one hidden between the interns has certainly made his point, and it looks like that match between Alan Morph and Wayne Coyle has another extra element added to it. We can't wait to see that at Downfall.
I'm kind of surprised so that intern would have that power, Mike, to make a match like that.
Maybe there's politics going on. Maybe there's a little bit of arm twisting going on. You never know.
Are we sure it was an intern?
We don't know. We may never know. Mm-hmm. It's a mystery to us all.
What about you at home? Have you heard a story like this before? Maybe right in if you have been affected by an
intern in your life.
Did we make it up? Or is it true? Join us after the break when we reveal
fact or fiction.
Fact or future. Yeah, I like it. We made it up. It's total fabrication. Wrestling's fake. So, moving on.
Lads, he said the F word.
Oh. I did. Ooh. Watch out. They're going to be out to get me. So
Foxy's literally like texting the boys.
So
Laddie, he said the F word.
He did. Get him, fellas.
It was him.
So, in that case, then we get the bell ringing again. I get the ring announcer. Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is scheduled for one fall.
One fall.
Introducing to the ring first. Weighing in at 237 pounds from County Cork, Ireland, Jim E. Morris.
That's a piss break match.
I was definitely paying attention. I would say that's funny, but I actually wasn't paying attention there. You would have had the whole match and I would have just been on my phone just texting someone.
Aww, I wouldn't have
fucking popped at all. It was only because he said Jim and my brain went, oh, this is me. Okay, right.
This is my finale.
Reminds me that, like, when I made a rent for the CCW show and everyone wasn't paying attention and suddenly my music hit, the whole house was like, is that the main event? And I just was like, oh shit! So I ran out and my glasses landed and I got them and I fired them at the announcer's desk because I had to get popped.
Oh god. Ever the professional. So, Aaron, talk us through your entrance. Obviously, Jimmy Morris is still getting changed apparently, going by the rush
in
their voice. Yeah.
But because I couldn't change quick enough and I wasn't paying attention, my tights are over my pants.
Of course they are.
So let's just go with that.
You can experience, I'm sure.
No, I never did that, no fairness. But anyway, yeah, let's go.
You can dress up as a
bird. Now, that does ring a bell. anyway, so...
Thing is, none of you ever actually saw me live when I actually did it. I was fucking over. All right,
you have sent us the video. Well, you've sent me videos of it, or there was clips. So I mean, like, I'm like, half of me is like really happy that I never had to see this live, and then the other part of me is highly disappointed that I've never gotten to see this live.
Hmm. That weird kind of duality of like what, which one wins out?
Schrodinger's like wrestling gimmick.
Schrodinger's gimmick. Is it over? Is it not over? We never know. No one saw it. So after Mars eventually gets to jump into the ring, we get the music of his opponent. And his opponent, weighing in at 235 pounds from County Waterford, Ireland, Cyrus Gold. So Cyrus is being joined to the ring by the Rose family, Garrick, Thorn, and Fred Rose himself, all coming out with him to essentially form, like not necessarily a guard of honor, but certainly taking strategic places down the ramp as a commentator's villain going. Well, it's not to say that Cyrus Gold has certainly taken the money, but nevertheless, he has certainly made it very, very clear which side his bread is buttered, and it's certainly on the side of the Rose family. He certainly got his worth out of it. He does get a challenge title shot before anyone else at Downfall, as he goes up against Violet Storm on night one of our two-night special. But for now, it is up to, I suppose, him to try and put an emphasis on this match that Jimmy Morris has with the Rose family. To bear in mind, there are some ramifications for both sides, depending on how that match goes. So our goal is now here to try and get an edge on the 20-year-old veteran. So, Aaron, this is going to be a 9-spot match between myself and you. So let's roll and get started.
I'll go first.
Yes. Okay, go for it. Oh, look, it's a 12. How about that? Yeah, it works. Okay, so
I wasn't cheating. Right? Sometimes it just happens. Watch.
There you go.
That's how I get my rolls. Stay with her.
I'm taking all those next rolls as yours, by the way. But, no, anyway. Right. So what do you want to going over the momentum. So what would you like to do for your first spot?
I'm going to... just immediately run towards him and go straight for his knee by hitting him with a sort of a 2-footed kick into his knee, and that's where I'm going to hit him with a senton right into the back. So basically when I hit him with the knees, he's going to fall on the stomach, and then I'm going to get up, I'm going to bounce off the ropes and senton right into his back.
So it's kind of a mix of a reel and a look roll, and both of them are the same stats. I'm going to go for a -1 on that, Jim, if that's okay. And that gets you across the line, actually. You do get the momentum out of it, so well done. So yeah, it's a bit of a rush, I suppose. Like, you do kind of... is there any more damage on the knee, let's say, and at the same time, there's a bit more of a delay to it. And you do obviously hit the both moves. So that it's a hot start to the match for you, Jimmy Morris. So let's get to our next spot and see what happens next. As a 6, and Cyrus rolled 8. So Cyrus, you rolled a go straight for the senton, and I think I want him to kind of obviously be recovering from that from a little bit. So he's going to try and take the corner, and as you're doing that, I want you to approach him. He's going to give you a boot to feed you back out, and what I'd like him to do then is to switch behind you, essentially give you a German suplex to get you across the ring. So that'll be a work roll for Cyrus, which is a -1. And that is successful for Cyrus Gold. So he hits you with German and you're vaulted across the ring. So some momentum for Cyrus Gold. Okay, Jim, give us your next roll. Let's see what happens next. That's an 8. And that beats my 4. So you take the next spot at the German suplex.
Right. So after the German, I'll have him running towards me. How big is he again?
About 6'2", 6'3", like he's certainly a broad as well. Like, so he does, like, he's about the same weight at the moment. So it's not necessarily neither of you are a deficit, but he has a height advantage on you
All right. So, but what I'll do so is let him run towards me. So I get up in the corner, he's running towards me. I move out of the way, he hits his chest off the ring post, and then I give him my own German suplex, but with a lot more because of how tall he is. A lot more sort of a strain to it. So it's more of just, I've sort of like sandbagged him over in a way.
Yeah. Okay, right. I will treat that as a work roll though for Jim, so that's a plus one for you. And that is successful on that one. So the return German suplex works as well. And we get to our next spot.
I think what I'll do is anything he can do, I can do better type thing.
I like that.
Even though I don't like the Rose family, we gotta kind of go with, like, I'm still better than him.
I like the way you think, because it happens to the first match. Yeah. So yeah, that works. Right. So what did you roll, Jim? That's a 7, and Cyrus roll 11. So he's going to use a bit of his power game here. So I want you to go for a pin after the German suplex. He's going to kick out. And I want you to feed him to his feet. It looks like you're going to line him up for a clothesline. But you're going to do what he's going to do instead. He's going to duck it. And when you're coming back to him then, he's going to go for a big Simone drop. That's what he's going to go for. So it'll be a power roll for Cyrus Gold. And the plus one gets him across the line. So momentum for Cyrus Gold there. And we move on to our next spot from there. So he hits a Simone drop. And we go for our next move. So, Aaron, let's see if you win the roll. That is an 8. And Cyrus rolls 10. So he's going to continue on the power moves here. So he's going to go for deadlift, good wrench from there, from when you're on the ground. So he's not giving you any chance to breathe, really. So good wrench. Hopefully gets across the ring with another power roll. And again, that's another successful roll for Cyrus Gold. So we move on to our next spot from there. So, Jim, give us your next roll.
I don't have to laugh that Amy said, you know, oh, it's a piss break match. And literally, we could be saying that I'm doing the most mental shit in this match and not one of them would pay attention. Everyone's just on it, looking around, looking down, and I'm like, oh, yeah, that was good.
It's important you learn this, Aaron, from... it's better you heard it from me rather than anything else, okay? So, let's see if...
You got a 10 there.
10, and that beats my 6. So yeah, he said a good range power bomb, and either we can recover, kick out, pinfall, whichever suits you best, Aaron. Take it away.
I'll kick out from that, and let me. It's going to sound ludicrous now, but I wanted to keep to what I was doing. I'm going to get up. He's going to run towards me. I'll duck it. We'll both run off the ropes. He's going to go for another clothesline on me. I'll duck that. And as he runs towards me, I'll stop and use his movement against him and hit him with a Samoan drop. That takes all of my power again out of me and yes. Just fucking slam it. And as I get up, then I see, I can even do that better.
Well, we'll see if the roll is successful. It's a power roll for you, which is a straight roll. So let's see if it works out. And it does. So you do hit the Samoan drop. So lovely stuff on that. And again, you can emotion to even the Rose family watching, like, have ringside going, huh? You know, just saying. Better on the wrong horse, all that sort of shit. So let's go to our next spot here. We have 3 spots left in this match. Let's see who gets the most out of it. That is a 9, and Cyrus also rolls 9. So we go again. That's an 8, and Cyrus rolls 10. So yeah, I want you to kind of like mount it a little bit to the Rose family. So enough for, say, someone like Garrick or Dahlia to kind of stand up and kind of reply back to you. Not necessarily enough for a distraction, but it just breaks the action a little bit for Cyrus to get a bit of separation. And what I'd like him to do from there is go for a chop block, basically from your back and where you're down there. So we'll treat that as a reel. So for Cyrus, that is plus one. And it actually does get it, would you believe? So he gets the momentum out of that. Chop block brings you down to the mat, and we take the next off from there. So let's see what happens next. Ooh. I think I fancy your chances, Aaron. There you go. I think you won that one, Aaron.
Yeah, I think I did.
Fucking game. Yeah.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes. Anyway, to be fair, it didn't matter what he rolled. He was always going to win that. He was going to win that score.
Yeah.
So. Anyway, so you have the momentum perk available. So what would you do for this spot?
What did he do to me again last? Did he do anything?
He went for chop block. So he's kind of working over your leg at the moment. So.
Right. Okay. So what I'm going to do is... Simon went wave and I was like, what? I want you to pay attention to the screen.
It's okay, Dave's trying out a new gimmick. Don't mind him. So...
Right, he's hit me with the chop block. I'm going to roll out of the ring. Go with overlayable, but I don't know what else to do. Roll out of the ring. Let him chase me. He's going to chase me outside. And once I get back in, which I'll be just about quicker, even though my leg is a little bit bossed up. And I'm limping a bit. Once he gets back in, I will hit him with another senton as he's like half and half out from sliding in.
You used that kind of yard difference. Fair. Okay. For all of that, I'm going to treat that as a look roll, Jim. So minus one on that. That is successful. So you do hit him with a senton from that. So and that's the momentum for you as well. So lovely stuff. Okay, this is the last last spot before the finish. So let's see who gets the last bit of momentum. That is a 10. And Cyrus also rolls 10. We go again.
6.
That is a 6. And Cyrus kept the roll at 10. So, yeah, you're working on the senton here. So, I kind of... What I'd like you to do is... you're certainly still working on the whole aspect of, like, anything you can do, I can do better. So, I want you to go for the good red powerbomb. But again, because you've been... you've been kind of drawing attention to the fact that you don't quite have the same brute strength that he does. He's going to block the go red powerbomb, and he's going to charge you into the corner. And what I'll get him to do then from there is, because he doesn't need to do that much at all in this business, we're going to do a top rope superplex. Because we do very rarely do superplexes in this show, so let's do a superplex. So I'm going to treat that as a look roll. So that'll be a minus one for that. Let's see if Cyrus pulls it off. And you know what? It's a good thing. It's probably a reason why we don't do superplexes, because that minus one is actually going to prevent him from doing it. So he's going for the superplex. Jimmy Morris, take it from here. How do you reverse it?
So as he's trying to do it to me, I'll push him off, and then fuck it, I'm right as well. I'm going to go for a frog splash off the top rope. Once he hits the bottom, I'll go straight for the frog splash.
Frog splash, eh? All right then. Jimmy Morris frog splash, toad splash, maybe. And you know what? That is successful.
Toad splash.
There you go. I like that. So, toad splash hits. Quite good form on it, has to be said. And even the ropes are starting to stand to attention. I go, okay, this is an issue here. So we get to the finish of the match then. So, Jimmy Morris, you're in the ascendancy here. So, what would you like to do to end this match?
Well, once I hit the frog splash, I'm going to, I'm not going to do anything. He's going to try and get me in for a brass ring. He's going to try and lock it on me. He grabs my arm on the way down, but he can't quite get it in. And then I move my arm off him and force it to try and get it on me. And I'm going to wrench it in and get the tap.
Okay, right. So, we're working on that.
You're going to use the golden rings then, yeah?
The line is out. Let's see if he bites.
Well, I mean, shut up.
Right. So for Cyrus, what I like him to do is, I like the idea of you going for the brass ring yourself. So
hold on, the one person paying attention to your match, and you have the indecency to insult him for it. You have one fan in this, and you literally just told him to fuck off.
We never said Jimmy Morris.
I've got two fans, right? James Rage, the character, might hate me, but in reality,
Jamie's gone. Jamie is gone, though. He's literally taking care of his child.
He's here in spirit, all right?
He's
not actually here in spirit at all. His screen is gone.
Out of curiosity, what matches up after this?
Is Casey for Salamon is the next match. But we're doing right, segment in between. Yeah.
Right, Grant. I'll be back in 2 minutes. So.
No problem. Work away. In that case, yeah. So, I like the idea of you going for
Foxy, count her out. Count her out where she's gone. She's not showing up in the match. Count her out.
Yeah, you work away. Come on, Foxy. Look at this. No, he's gone. So, I like the idea of you of a plan of you in the brass ring at the finish. So what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to essentially do exactly what you did there, is to him to a golfer first, you reapply it, wrench it in. He's gonna tap out, but what happens is we notice the referee's been directed away by the Rose family. That gives the likes of Garrick and Thorne a chance to basically come in and hit finishing moves on you. Sars goal then comes in and finishes you off with the gold plating, and that's how he wants his match to finish. So that's essentially seeing if interference happens for the finish or not. So with that in mind then, momentum-wise, Jimmy Morris, you are on 8, and Sars Gold is on 5. So we're both devoting momentum to this, no doubt. So I will set the pace. Let's see if we can match it. And, okay, you know, this is manageable. You've got 12 to beat, Aaron. Never in doubt. You've got the finish, no problem. So, so what I have here is, and so yeah, you're gonna win clean essentially. So, Cyrus Gold is going to go for the brass ring. You reverse it, Aaron. Take it from here and tell us what happens.
So I leave it in a little bit longer. He taps out eventually. The Rose family comes in and. What I'm going to do then is, with sort of no help, albeit a bit of a struggle, I will start taking them out one by one, in a sense. So, with Cyrus going already gone, because he just tapped out and he's out. So, he's out of the ring, right?
Yeah.
I've been tagging with him for months. Who the fuck's in the Rose family again?
Damon Garrick.
My brain is like, Damon Garrick. He'll run towards me first. I'll immediately pull the ropes down, let him dive out. He's gone. And Dahlia Thorne, that's the other one, isn't it?
Dahlia Thorne, yeah.
Ah, I fucking remember that. She's going to run towards me, and I'll immediately get her grabbed up in the belly-to-belly and fuck her over the top rope as well, on top of the two lads.
Okay, right. All right, I will allow
this. It starts off, like, because if it's the last show, I suppose the face would get the... pop going into the
a bit momentum. Of a pop, yeah, that's fair. Okay, there's one thing I will
like propose. WWF there, huh?
There you go, you know, on the faces. So, there's one thing I will propose. Can you give me one very quick roll? And I shall roll as well just to see who wins out. Okay, that's grand. No, I was gonna challenge you on a roll there, but that's fine. You can work away here. So, Rose is gonna obviously have a like a face of seething rage on his no offense, Jamie. A face of like anger on his complexion there, and he's just gonna go like. Obviously, he looks like he wants to try and intervene himself, but he kind of like, you know, he's kind of tempted to go down, but obviously Jimmy Morris is still in the ring, going, "Come on in," and just like whatever kind of emotion, you're kind of emotionally like, you know, your time's up, that sort of shit, but then Rose will, you know, obviously lick his wounds, and he'll go away for another night, which then leaves the ring announcer to just simply say, ladies and gentlemen, your winner by submission, Jim E. Morris.
Can I add a little bit into this as well, right?
So you can absolutely. When the one
Fred Rose takes the bag from the side of the ring, of which he thinks is money, but as he's going up, he's like, I got it. I'm like, look in the bag, and he opens it up, and it's literally just pieces of paper and Monopoly money.
Yeah, I like that. And again, the company's go, well, if you were looking at the form guide, you'd have to say that Jimmy Morris is looking good for downfall. He's not only just made the new number one contender tap out in the middle of the ring, which will be music to the ears of Violet Storm, no doubt, but going into this this do or die match with themselves and the Rose family, it looks to be all for Jimmy Morris. The Rose family have to regroup and try again for next week, because otherwise, if that match ends the way it is now, the Rose family will be disbanded. And I, for one, welcome it. And we fade the commercial on that. So, lovely stuff there. So, when we come back then, Mike Dolan is going to be in chill mode. He's going to be talking about the two-night extravaganza that is Future Wrestling's downfall. And he will be going, well, folks, obviously we have an exciting night of wrestling ahead of us tonight, but our attention obviously is going to turn to our potentially final show of Future Wrestling itself, and indeed of season two, at least in that regard, the two-night extravaganza downfall. Let's run you through some of the matches that have been announced for that. Let's start off with night one, shall we? Obviously, the main event of that will be the proverbial five-card stud match, where the teams of Rob Midas and Fred Rose, Team Future Wrestling and Team VCR, going head-to-head for dominance and potential control of Future Wrestling. We know some of the people involved in the match. We will not know the full teams going in, but we do know that fighting for Future Wrestling will be James Rage and Kyle Decker. And on the opposite side, fighting for the network will be Casey Colt and Cutter. We obviously will not know who else is in that match until the night itself. Elsewhere on the card for night one will be a Future Wrestling title defense, as Violet Storm hits a speed bump on her way to her match against James Rage, as she has to defend her championship against Cyrus Gold. That match was made last week at the behest of Fred Rose for obviously obvious reasons. But for Violet Storm, it is just another challenge she'll have to take to confront James Rage on night two. Elsewhere, matches have been made left, right, and center over the week, and one of them involves the Youngbloods. Michaela Joyce and Joshua Delaney will take on each other in singles action to start off this two-night extravaganza. Obviously, tensions have been rising between the Youngbloods for quite some time, and as he does that, then the camera's going to cut to backstage, where we see Michaela Youngblood being attacked by Joshua Delaney. But not just Joshua Delaney, Foxy, Nathan Youngblood's there as well.
Yeah, so obviously, they decide to jump her in the back. Like the camera literally just,
catches it, yeah.
Yeah, it just changes over, and she's in the middle of being attacked. Like, don't know, this is in the backstage, so they're throwing her around, laying in a few shots, and basically, they are... So I'm trying to think in regards to whereabouts. So they're basically throwing in a few shots. Youngblood is getting Joshua to hold her so he can lay in a couple shots as well.
Hmm.
One or two straight shots they look really nasty, close fist, the body. It's just it's the uncomfortable kind of snug.
Yeah, snug shots, yeah.
But okay. As they're doing that, obviously they're not gonna fucking you're gonna have fucking Silver Fox jump out. He's coming in to make the save.
Okay.
He wasn't there, but he hears the commotion as it gets closer, he hears who it is, so he jumps in. So basically, starts a big brawl between the four of them. Michaela's starting to come back as well. She's trying to get a few shots in, but they're just spilling around the backstage area.
So let's hold our thought there, right? So let's make this a bit of a brawl then. So, how about I roll for Youngblood and you roll for Silver Fox then. And what we can do is we'll base trade shots from there, and they're all just free roll. We're just going to add to the segment and see what happens. So they're all free rolls from here. Let's just see who wins the spot. So let's go with maybe five spots for this one, Foxy, should be enough for back and forth. So and we get to a kind of crescendo from there. So I roll first. So can you be the five?
Yes, I can.
Yes, I can. Great. So Fox, you take it away then. So you're intervening here. It's going to spill out to the backstage. People getting involved. Talk us through what happens first.
It's it's the makings of a brawl. It's spilling around all the backstage area. Mm. At first, it's literally it's a little bit of a free for all, and then it doesn't go the way you think, where the rivals are battling each other. It's actually the opposite. So Fox is at Joshua and Michaela is actually at Youngblood.
Mm.
She's trying to get her own back for what Youngblood did, and Fox is making the save basically. But they're working away for a little bit. It's and tossing into the wall, tossing it onto tables, the catering table is getting flipped over, stuff like that. Minimal catering that we have, just a protein bar and a fucking can of Coke.
Yeah, cut out the whole lot, unfortunately. But you know, you get the idea.
Yeah.
Fine. So yeah, that works then. So let's see who takes initiative from the next one then. So let's go for another roll and see what happens.
Alt.
Definitely not me anyway. Oh wow, we actually rolled a 3. That's impressive.
What the fuck?
That's the second time in 2 weeks it's happened. Anyway, you're still in control, Fox. Take away to talk us through what happens next.
But yeah, like I'm sorry, I'm a bit fucking surprised about that one.
Same here.
But yeah, like it. So they're still brawling around fucking the area, but like it gets to a point where like people kind of like get separated for a little bit and then reconvene. So picture, if you will, it's like they're in the hallway and like two are brawling right in front of the camera. Like,
yes, and the others are going further away. Is that it?
Like, they're moving further away while two brawl into a room. You don't see it because the camera literally is just following these two.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
And then suddenly they just fucking reappear like further down the hall.
Like Scooby-Doo. Like, I like that. I like that idea.
So, like in the crosshair, like they actually, like, that's when they
it switches.
They switch up. Like,
oh, I like that.
We're going after. So,
okay. Yeah. I like that a lot. I like that a lot. Tell you what, then, right? What we do is, because you've done that then, let's have a spot between the two then. So if we do Michaela Joyce and Jack Delaney, have that focus on that spot, and then we can focus on Fox Youngblood after that then. So I'll roll for Michaela, and you roll for Delaney then. Let's see who wins out. Or sorry, I'll roll for Delaney, apologies. And you roll for Joyce. So I roll 9. And you roll 9 as well. Well, can't be separated. I'll go again. And that's 5, I roll 6. So I want Delaney to get the upper hand there, obviously, on Michaela Joyce. So Joyce is obviously trying to like fire up on Delaney as best she can, obviously, with the brawl. There's people still kind of shouting, rabbling, trying to get away. So the camera's going to be focusing on those two in particular first. And what I will get Michaela to do is in a sort of, I suppose, this is kind of a physio room almost. So so people are kind of dispersing from there, and essentially she's going to like hit Delaney over the head with kind of like a medic box, whatever it is. So she looks like going to go for a second shot, but Delaney's going to basically hurl her out over the, basically vault her out onto the wall of the medical room. She's going to take a nasty spill onto the kind of bench that's there. And we basically cut it back from there, essentially. So this goes down to Fox and Youngblood, so I'll roll for Youngblood and see what's happening in that part of the brawl. That's a 10, and I rolled 9. So, Fox, you're in control of the brawl.
So, Fox and Youngblood are like, fighting away. Like, Fox is getting the upper hand. He's, like, throwing a couple shots in. And I'm trying to think. So, like, Michaela and Joshua have kind of, like, separated, but we're... Whereabouts have they gone there?
So they went into kind of the medical room. So, yeah.
Yeah, they're in the medical room. Meanwhile, like Fox and Youngblood, they cross into the room. It's into the bigger, like fucking basically backstage area.
The hallway, so, yeah.
There's a truck there. It's near the parking lot. So, like, you're going to have the mix of everything there.
Mm.
But there's a lot of, there's a lot more goodies around, and yeah, it's getting dangerous. So,
okay, all right, yeah. All right, I see that. All right, so let's see. So, if we're in a parking lot, then we take it from this spot here. Let's see who takes advantage. Uh, 11, and I roll 5. So, Fox, you're still in control of the match.
So,
Raleigh.
Fox is still in control. He is, to the point where he clearly has the upper hand in this. He's getting a bit like you can see the anger really like coming out in Fox, and he's like really wailing on him on Youngblood, which is something that like we've only seen a handful of times, but like this is, it feels different.
Yeah,
it's not just your typical okay, I'm aggressive. No, this is like, there's some maliciousness in it, which has never been like Fox's way, yeah. Even when he was like a bad guy. But yeah, it's getting really like vicious and mean. That he's like, he sets Youngblood down. Like Youngblood is kind of like, it's kind of on one knee and he's kind of like hunkered down. But Fox kind of just walks off for a minute. And Cameron doesn't follow him because he's watching Youngblood. But like, yeah, then next time you see him, literally like the camera will pan and like Fox is out. He's after climbing on top of like this small little van that's there.
Oh, shit.
So.
Okay.
And the camera is literally like, what the hell is going on? So you literally just see out of corner, just, oh, shit. Fox literally runs, jumps, and fucking crashes right onto fucking Youngblood.
Jesus, okay. All right, and so that will end the brawl on that then. So it's a big finish, and both of them are in a horrible state on the ground, as we see kind of the likes of officials and Sundry kind of come out then to try and finally quell the brawl once for all. So the commentator will cover for here, going like, well, look, obviously our preview was halted there by this ridiculous carry on backstage. But as you can see here, Silver Fox, whatever this animosity he has to Nathan Youngblood has taken just more and more of an edge as time goes on. But I don't want to be one to question what on his motives here, but he is endangered himself and Nathan Youngblood there with that high risk maneuver. But either way, he'll have to get looked at from our medical professionals here. But a nasty split for both people there, and we're gonna have to cut the commercial on that, folks. We're gonna try and get an update again on what's happening here. There's a chaotic night again here at Future Wrestling, and we'll get back to you on the end at the end of this commercial break. So obviously Mike stumbles to the transition there, and then we come back. We get to our next match, ladies and gentlemen. This next contest is scheduled for one fall. One. Introducing to the ring first, weighing in at 232 pounds, the Diamond Woods in Dublin, Alan Moore!
Oh, the voice cracks are fucking rampant.
It's just there. It's really, it's in the middle of my throat. It really gets on my throat. Sorry, Casey, go for it.
God, we got enough. Really, really want to come out of the wolf tonight, but I'm going to come out of the snake. Black and white snake. Crawl to the ring. Crawls up the steps. As I'm crawling up the steps, because I'm Alan Moore, I trip and nut myself on the steps. Just for bounce. Gotta crawl, scurry into the ring, and I kind of sit down as a bad turnbuckle holding me balls. Fuck.
My mouth. So, the commentator's like trying to go, well, I know I've sung the praises of Alan Moore quite a lot over the last couple of years here in Future Wrestling, but no one really lightens the mood like this man right here. No matter what happens to him here at this show, he always brings a smile to people's faces. And good to see that tradition continues here tonight, despite his very clear discomfort in the middle
of the
ring.
It was the last one. And a little bit of Main Street.
So with that then, we hear the music of your opponent. And his opponent, weighing in at 188 pounds, hailing from Tombstone, USA, Casey Cole. So Amy, talk us to your entrance.
Sorry, my music's playing. I'm building the tension. Hold on.
Okay.
I also had her completely distracted with a podcast idea, and then we started bouncing off all the shit. That was the reason the two of us laughing.
To be honest, actually, yeah, that's that far. That's your error.
Yeah, fully distracted. Counter out.
Just very quickly wanted to get that pop in at Alex, but tell him just don't be a shit. Right.
Right.
So music's playing. Music playing, walking out to the ring, and just very much in a kind of sense of, do you actually do that? Do you okay? Do I, I'm starting to question, do I want to get in the ring with him actually after this? Because now it's gotten to a point where I'm like, if he's not more, like, he might be a bit of a danger to himself, but he's also probably going to be a danger to me. I can't believe I'm going to say this, and I'm really, really sorry for saying this, but I'm just never going to see him. But I'm getting a bit of a Seth Rollins injury vibe off this one. Like, remember when he did it to Cena and broke his nose, and then he ended a career, and then he broke someone's, like, dislocated someone's shoulder. I'm starting to get that vibe off Alan Morph right now. I think he might be a bit of a danger to get into the ring with. But himself, I'm getting paid maybe to be here. Nah. Stupidity manages to hurt those around you. So,
that was a jab at somebody.
very tentatively, I'm walking into the ring.
Very well.
Standing very, very, very far in the corner.
Okay. So, in that case, guys, you have 9 spots for this match. So, guys, take it away, please. So, let's see who wins the first roll.
Fuck you, Aaron.
In your own time.
Yeah, you will wait for my own time. Oh, shit, wrong camera.
Fair. 7 to beat Casey.
I drew a 7.
Oh, drew a 7. We go again, so. That's a 9.
That's a 3.
That's a 3. So, Casey, you start this match off.
Okay, so first thing I'm going to ask, are you okay? Like, are you actually okay? Like, do you want to, are you sure you want to do the match? You don't, like, we can call it off. Look, no one's going to think any less of you, dude. We can
she wants it. Wait, sorry. Ref, she wants the match called off. Shouldn't that be a victory to me?
I'm asking. That's a forfeit. I believe what I'm doing.
That's a forfeit.
I believe what I'm doing is giving you the chance to walk away.
Yeah. That shows you're a fucking season 2 blowing. I never walk away.
You're going to wish that you did.
Yeah.
You're very much so going to wish that you walked away from me. So what I'm going to do then to start this match is I'm going to kick straight for the gut and then hit him in with a bulldog straight onto the mat.
Right then. That'll be a look roll for Casey Colt plus 1. And it's successful. So you get your first momentum of the match and we go from there. So, guys, give us your next roll. See what happens next. That's a 6 for Casey.
4
for Kate for Alan Morph. So, Amy, you take the spot.
So height. I'm not saying this to be insulting. Height wise, how tall is Alan Morph?
I think he's a 5'8", 5'9".
So Casey's taller than him.
Yeah, I'm in my bollocks. No, yeah. I'm 5 yeah,
no,
exactly.
Well, no.
How tall is Alan Morph? Not yeah. You.
Oh, 5'8". If he's 5'8", he's taller than me. I'm 5 exactly.
Okay. We actually did measure this as well. Anyone who watches Weekend at Amy's, I think at one point of one of our episodes, we actually measured each other. We all stood in height and stood in order just to see who was in fact tallest. It was Jonathan. Shocking.
Excuse me. My head was
out
camera.
So,
shockingly tall, for the record. I wasn't expecting you to be as tall as you were.
I wasn't expecting you to be as short as you were when I saw that photo. I was like, what the fuck?
I said this to Kira. Did I not say this at the time? Did I say this at the time, Kira?
Yeah, but I think they're getting a skew of you. I think we were standing on flat?
Standing on flat. And unless he's fucking angled his camera a particular way to make you look really fucking tall.
That is entirely possible. I'm a terrible photographer.
Then Jamie, you kick his fucking ass when you see him again. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to... What's Alan wearing?
Have you got a special gear on for
this? Is there a collar? Is there a hood?
I don't think so. It'll be just a mask and a snake onesie.
So scruff of the onesie then. So what I'm going to do then is pull him up by the scruff of the onesie, set him up for an unprettier and smack him down again. I'm going straight for the face on this one. I'm making sure that there's a possible concussion or knockout on this.
Okay. Well, in that case, you're going to go for a real roll, which is a plus two. And that's critical. So, yeah. So, that is it's a spike on prettier at that. So, Alan Moore's going to take a nasty spill from there. And again, you can hear the crowd going, ooh, looks nasty and so forth. And again, the referee kind of like asks Casey to kind of back off for a moment, the checks on Alan Moore. And we take the next spot from there. So, guys, give us your rolls. Let's see what happens next. 10?
11.
11. So, Alan Moore, you answer. So obviously, you've taken a nasty, unprettier bump there. So, the referee's checking on you, seeing if you're okay. So, how do you reply to that?
As he approaches me, I'm like, I shove the ref away. Mm. And I go for a scissors kick on Colt.
Oh, I like it. Okay. So, all right. That'll be a luck roll for you then, Alan Moore. Plus one.
Six.
It gets you across the line. So you get your momentum out of that, Alan Moore. Nicely done. So let's get to our next spot, lads. Let's see what happens next. That's 10 for Amy.
Nine.
Oh, lucky. So Casey Cole takes control from here. So you've been hit with a scissors kick by Alan Moore. How do you reply?
Is that like a Booker T scissors kick?
That's what I presume, yeah.
That's what I'm thinking, yeah.
Or you mean a bicycle kick?
Oh, yeah, like bicycle, like bro kick kind of thing.
Ah, okay, right.
So, like a big boot type thing.
Yeah, yeah, okay, right.
Grand, okay, because I was thinking I'm not in a position to get hit with a scissors kick. So I was like, I don't know how this is after working.
I presume it was like a punch to go, but yeah, carry on.
Yeah, okay, so big kick into the face on this one. Stumble back a little bit. Only to kind of mutter, you little shit. And then just go straight onto it. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for, I'm going to go actually for a standing drop kick.
Standing drop kick. Okay. That'll be a look over Casey plus one. And that is successful. So momentum for again for Casey as we move on to our next spot. So roll again, guys, if you don't mind.
10.
7.
Seven, right. So, Alan Moore, if you take the spot, so you just take a standing drop kick. How do you reply?
Drop kick, I stumble back off the ropes, off the middle rope. Mm-hmm. Want her to go for another drop kick, boy catch up, slam her down, and stack her up for a pin.
Okay, you're going to go for a work roll on that then. So, that's a plus one for you.
Ooh, 8.
8, which makes it a 9. So, a positive roll for you, Amy, down to the pinfall. Never in doubt. So that's a 1, 2, and a kick out from there. So,
hey, John, do I have to go?
Do you want to take over your rolls?
Yeah.
Okay, grand. So, right. Can we get the next roll, please?
You can tell you're someone who's never. You can tell you're someone who's never had to work in like a call center setting.
Yes. Thank fuck. So you take this roll, Amy. So take care of this.
What was the last thing that he did? Sorry.
He basically went a section for a pin, essentially. So I think he said, what was it?
Right, it was a pin. Yeah. He went for okay. How many match or not matches? Sorry, how many moves do we have left?
We have 4 spots left after this.
Four spots. This
is, yeah, 4 more spots. Yeah.
What's my momentum? What's him momentum?
You have Anamorph is 3, and you have 4.
Okay, right. Right. What I'm going to do then is. So getting out of the pin, I'm going to catch him by the leg and hit him in for a Boston crab. Trying to see if I can start weakening the legs.
Fair. Okay. Yeah, I'll treat that as a work roll minus one.
Okay, it still works.
That still works. Yeah. So he's in the Boston crab and custom roll to see. So are you treating this more as a wear down than anything else or?
Wear down because I don't think I don't have enough. It wouldn't be enough to try and go for a pin on it.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Fair enough. I know what you mean. Cool, Grant. And we'll.
My door just opened by itself.
Wind? Draft?
No, the door was legit closed. Like the handle and everything had to go down on that.
I've seen a movie exactly like this.
Yeah, so have I. That's why I'm worried. salt.
What kind of fucking Freaky Friday shit is this?
Right, we had him in a Boston Crab.
Yes.
We're down.
Yeah. All right, and now we're going to our next spot from here. So. And that's 11. That beats my 10. So, Amy, you take it from here.
Okay. I'm legit a little bit terrified. Do I still have you in the crab?
Can do. I mean, he didn't grab the ropes or anything like that. We kind of kept it as a wear down. So he let go or he grabs the ropes or...
No, fuck him. Fuck this, actually. What I'm going to do then is I'm going to try and see if I can remember how to do this. So do you know when Bull McKenna goes in for the inverted, kind of like an inverted sharpshooter and then gets the arms?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm going to go for that. I can't think of what it's called, but you know what it is?
I do know. I know exactly what you're thinking of. I kind of work, kind of power, so we minus one altogether. So go for that roll and see what happens.
And I'm working on a minus one.
We're on a minus one, yeah.
Okay, that was a fail. I'm going
to
drop
it. It will be. I'll tell you what, I want you to actually go for that visual, so I want you to actually certainly go for it. So Adam Orff will be stuck in it for a little while, but he's obviously going to wiggle his way out. I want him to basically shoot for a leg that'll take you down to the mat, and I want him to go for a I want to go for a bank statement on that, as Adam Orff does like a bank statement. So be a plus one work on that. And it is over the line. It's a 7. So it's not a strong submission in a sense. So you're only in it for a couple of while and you can rope break from there. So we take our next spot from the separation. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And let's get the next roll from there. And that is a 5 and a 10. So you take the next spot from there after the bank statement.
What the hell is a bank statement again?
It's basically, it's essentially a crossface.
Okay, thank you. Jesus, it has been a fucking while since I've watched WWE. If I can't even remember what that shit was. Yeah. Okay, so leg to the bottom rope, then that gets him to kind of drop that one. Okay, at this point, I think I'm done playing games because I think we're nearly out of moves as well, aren't we?
Two more left after concluding this.
Okay, so what I'm going to do then is... as we're kind of separating, he's kind of got his back to me. I'm going to shove the ref in a sense, kind of get him out of the way and go straight for a... Oh, I hate that I'm doing this. Okay, I'm going to take a move from Nikki Bella.
Oh, God.
I'm going to go for her rack attack.
That's not the torture rack, is it?
It's basically, it's like when she lifts them up on the sides, but then she slams down on the knees.
Ah, yes, I remember it now.
Isn't that the move that completely fucked her neck, That's the one that...
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to treat that as a power roll, because you're lifting them up to do it, so it'll be a minus one, and that's more than enough. So you get the momentum out of that, and this is our last spot before the finish, so last momentum available, let's see who wins it. That is an 8. I roll 8 as well. We go again. That's 10. Beats my 7. So the last spot goes to you, Amy. What would I like to do?
I'm gonna fucking turn one over on him, and I'm going to put him in a crossface.
Very good. Very good. That'll be a work roll for you as well, then. So minus 1. And it is in. So again, same story as last time. You get the momentum out of it, but he'll get out of it fairly quickly as well. So we get our separation from there, and we roll on to our finish. So, Casey Cole, you are in the ascendancy. How would you like to finish this match?
After kind of releasing him on that one, I'm not going to give him much breathing room. I'm going to lock the legs around the waist and go straight for a chicken wing finisher.
Straight for chicken wing. Fair enough. Let's see. What will I go for then? So... I mean, the only thing I think of really is a surprise roll up. That's the only thing I can go for, really. Like, you're going for a recoil and just he stacks you up, essentially. It's a bit the same as the Midas finish, but It's kind of the best I can think of on the spot here. So, yeah, okay, we'll go with that.
Jamie has an option.
For what it's worth, I'm happy to come out and slap her around.
Right.
Right. So, momentum wise, that is a Animorph has 4 and Casey Gold has 7. So, I will set the pace with my roll. Again, going for surprise roller. Jeez. I fancy your chances. Never in doubt. Never in fucking doubt. So, yeah, talk us through the finish then. You're going for the CrossFit chicken wing, lock it in and take it home.
So so release the cross face on this one here, not really kind of giving him that much of a chance straight away with the leg lock around the waist and get him into a chicken wing dead center in the ring and just kind of retching back until he taps. She's not going to be a cunt about it. She is going to let go once that happens.
Okay, that's fair enough then. Fair enough, Grant. And and the referee will oblige with that then and call the submission. Ladies and gentlemen, your winner by submission, Casey Cold. So, Amy, any match afters on that one?
Just kind of let him go. Pull him up so he's sitting in the middle of the ring.
Yeah.
Like, just so he's literally sitting in the center of the ring.
Mm.
And very, very, the word I'm thinking of here. Very condescending, like just pat him on the head.
Patronizing, yeah.
That's what patronizing. Just give him a little pat on the head, roll out of the ring, and head off back upstairs.
Right, fair enough.
As if like what did he say? He came out dressed as a wolf, or did he change that?
I didn't go. I was jokingly kind of about the wolfing earlier on. No, I think he's talking about for kind of generics of last time. Was it kind of like a? Did he say it was a snake? Thing he had on?
I couldn't remember what he said it was.
Snake, wasn't it? Yeah, so it was a snake he has on, yeah, and with the orc mask to go with.
Yeah, so it's very much a very patronizing, good boy, solid effort, pat on the head, and then just leave.
I like it a lot. So Casey then walked out from there, and the commentators go, I think Casey's made her point there. Emphatic victory again, against the former world champion in his own right, but like I said, Alan Morphy has bigger fish to fry when it comes to downfall, and this is not the ideal preparation for it. But for Casey Cult, this is exactly what she wanted. And downfall awaits for the captain of Team Network. Let me fade it back on that. So, right. So next up then is the Wraith promo. So, Dave, we have a bit of kind of leeway in which way to do this in terms of the kind of visual and so forth, because obviously we don't have kind of cutter tonight. So, as we kind of make it more like a kind of a visual thing more than anything else, because actually kind of address the audience or which way we want to do it. So, again, we're going to have Mike Dublin trying to do a rundown as he left it from the last time, and essentially the moment he kind of mentions the Wraith on 9-2, it cuts out from there, and we see the Wraith individual on screen. So,
sounds good.
Dave, set the scene for us. What are we seeing in front of us here?
So, is this backstage, or is he out in the ring?
Whichever way you want to do it. Okay, you have free reign here.
I would say Cutter is making his way to the ring to address me.
Okay.
But when he gets to the ring, he leans over, grabs a microphone from, you know, the helper or whatever is at ringside, but he's noticing that his microphone isn't working. It's kind of like tapping on it and nothing's coming through. So he grabs another one. Same thing again, not working. So he notices he's going nuts. Like, he's just walking around the ring, like asking everyone at ringside, like, what the fuck's going on? None of these microphones are working. He's just getting really frustrated now. So then the arena goes dark. The red spotlight shines on Cutter. And then on the Tron, it comes up, but it comes up per letter, kind of fades in, the message comes up and basically says the Wraith wants to be slain by a monster, but if the monster can't be killed, it will stay forever and Cutter will be destroyed.
And yeah, so we can kind of, we get the text, we kind of hear that kind of kind of white knights to go with and so forth. Mm-hmm. And we can kind of see, you imagine Cutter's kind of response is like, that's what it's all about. And it is essentially who is the biggest monster.
Yep.
And he kind of stands there and just kind of drops the microphone there and he goes, all right. And presumably the red light will kind of follow him away from, okay, great.
Pretty much follows him up the ramp and he kind of just goes backstage in a focused manner. He's like, okay, all right.
Mm. All right, okay, fair enough. Yeah. And again, the commentators go, well, I suppose is this what this is all about in a sense? Before this happens then, as Cutter's kind of coming up the arena, we just hear this kind of like ethereal howl, which it sounds like from Cutter because you can just kind of hear it in the arena. It's just, it's loud in a sense. And kind of with this kind of weird kind of like laughter to go with, like very kind of unhinged. But as like kind of Mike is going to go, well, I can only assume that is the Wraith, but it certainly didn't sound like, it's actually sounded more like Cutter. But anyway, some very strange scenes here at ringside, and it is going to get stranger because this red light is not going anywhere anytime soon. We are going to see the Wraith very soon here in action. He's going up against Kyle Dekker, and obviously the gauntlet's been set down by Fred Rose earlier on today. He is looking to gain some points on his opponents for downfall, and what better way than to unleash whatever this menace is on Kyle Dekker and his cohorts. So with that then, the lighting I'd like to stay in a sense, like it's still kind of quite dark, but you do the music of Kyle Dekker kind of hits here at this point. And we obviously get the ring bell and so forth. And he goes,
yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is scheduled for one fall. To the ring first, weighing in at 207 pounds from Neo Kobe City, Kyle Dekker. So he comes out then, obviously, and the lighting is obscuring the crowd and so forth. And it's kind of like that white noise is still kind of in the arena as such. So it's drowning out his music ever so slightly. So he's kind of standing around and kind of seeing what he can see in a sense, but the ring is the only thing really in sight. So he's kind of very cagously taking steps up towards it. No kind of like muted, like kind of like very kind of muted movements altogether. Like he is just essentially kind of taking his time coming in, kind of checking his six and all that sort of stuff, mm-hmm. because he knows how this guy operates. So he's kind of waiting, essentially in the kind of the middle of the ring. He won't. He'll take the corner. He's going to take the far right corner of the ring and basically wait to see what happens from there. So cool. In that case, then, so we hear the Wraith music hit, and Dave, take it from here.
So obviously the arena is a bit darker. Wraith's music will hit. So what will happen is he'll come out from behind the curtain and walk down the ramp, kind of a real menacing grin on his face. But on each arm, he's got a black sleeve on each arm. And on the right one in red, it reads RIP Dekker on the right arm.
Mm-hmm.
And then makes his way down to the ring, slides in, stays on his kind of hands and knees, kind of edge style.
Mm.
And then kind of works his way up.
And then Congress go. Well, we've seen, I think this perhaps is the first time we've actually seen this individual appear in the ring, as it were, traditionally. But just got to show you the altered state that this person is living in right now. As for picking fights with the likes of Cutter and so forth, you can certainly see if he wants to be the only monster in the future wrestling. And certainly you pick on the biggest one in the locker room. But for now, for tonight, this is such an unusual clash between these two. But as you can see on the lettering there, it seems to be etched into in the arm of the Wraith there. There's certainly something between these two. This dynamic is perhaps a little more complicated than we think. So, Dave, this is between me and you. So it's going to be a 10-spot match altogether. So let's get into it and see who wins out.
Nine. Ooh.
So... what I'd like to do to start off is, you're getting up to your feet here at the moment, right?
Yeah.
Grant. As you're getting up on your feet, I've still kind of got my kind of ring gear on, or my hold on and so forth like that. So kind of looks like I'm going to get rid of that, but then essentially
double spot or double momentum?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I should have specified. I'm going for double momentum here. So
cool.
So what I'd like to do for that is I want you to start charging at me.
Yeah.
And essentially it looks like I'm going to do the same thing, but I'm actually going to throw my code in your kind of like in your face essentially.
Okay.
And go for a shotgun drop kick from there and basically kind of kick you, hopefully fire you into the corner from there. So that'll be a look roll for me, which is a straight roll. And that is successful. So I get my momentum out of it. And we could basically take the next shot from there. So okay. Yeah. So Dave, take it away.
11.
I roll 7. So you take the next spot from here.
So what I'll do from here is I'll kind of come out of the corner, take the jacket off, toss it out of the ring, just kind of huff and puff. I'm quite frustrated at the start. And what I want to do is, I don't know whether this can be all done in the same spot, but I want to hit him with a couple of stiff forearms, whip him against the ropes and go for spinebuster.
Spinebuster. Yeah, that's possible. Go for shots in the spinebuster. I'm going to treat that all as a power roll. So that'd be a +1 to you.
Okay.
And that gets you across the line. So you get momentum out of that and we want to next spot from there.
Cool. 4.
4 and I roll 5. So you're going for the spine buster. So I want you to kind of like stay on top of me and start lettering in shots, basically, like left and right. Obviously, they're very stiff shots. Referee's telling you to ease up, but you're not listening, essentially. So I want Decker to kind of like start swatting away some of these shots. He's going to work on, he's going to grab basically your arm. He's going to grab your arm, basically. Looks going to trade you through for one of those kind of side lock pins, but he's going to transition out of it basically and go for a DDT from there. So kind of like a float over DDT. So that'll be a work roll for him. And he gets the roll out of it. So he gets momentum for that.
Cool.
And we move on to our next spot from there.
Ooh.
That's 12. And I roll 10. So this spot goes to you, Dave. And perks available if you want it.
Double momentum, please.
Certainly. And what spot would you like to do?
So what am I getting up from again? You've basically
Float over DDT. So it's like one of those ones where I've shot your arm, shot, grabbed your arm. I've threaded you through almost like in a roll. Okay. As you fed back up, basically, I've kind of like propelled, basically used my momentum to shoot you into the mat with a DDT.
Okay. So what I want to happen is obviously I'm still reeling a bit, selling the DDT, holding my head, feeding up. You're feeding up at the same time.
Yeah.
So what I want to do then is I want to mirror that
and
kind of just, as you're feeding up, I feed up a little bit faster, hook your head in with and hit a double arm DDT.
Double arm DDT. Cool. Yeah, that's possible. That'll be a -1 to your work there. No, what?
11.
Oh, never in doubt. So you get your double momentum out of it anyway with a double arm DDT. Lovely stuff. And we get to our next spot from there.
10
for me as well. Ooh. So we go again.
6, 7. Oh.
So you go for the underhook DDT. So I'm kind of recovering from there. So I'm gonna roll out of the ring to get a catcher breather. you're not gonna waste long though coming back in. So you're gonna go out the opposite side of the ropes.
Okay.
And look to grab me back into the ring, which you do. So I'm starting to try and get some distance. You're coming back in, and I'm essentially going to go for a. As you're coming back into the ring, I'm going to go for sweep your legs and go for a rope assisted elbow drop. So basically, going to use the ropes to get a lift from it. So that'll be a look roll for myself, and that is a 10. So momentum for me there. And we get to our next spot from here.
So 10.
And that is a 7. So you take it from here. Dave, what would you like to do?
So I'm coming again, feeding back up from a springboard, was it? Springboard off the
ropes? Essentially a springboard elbow, yeah.
Springboard elbow. So what I'll want to do then is to take a bit of a breather.
Mm-hmm.
Is I want to, after the elbow, feet up and just hit you with a belly to back suplex, just a German. Well, not a German, but a
front.
Yeah, suplex. Basically just a belly to back suplex.
Mm-hmm.
And just get a bit of time to get back up and get focused.
Okay, fair. Yeah, I'll treat that as a work roll, so that'll be a minus one to you.
Okay. Ooh, lucky. Nine.
That's enough. You get the momentum out of it anyway. And I suppose, like, in that case, I'll roll out of the ring then. That'll give you a reader then.
Yeah.
That's the case. Yeah. Nice. So cool. I'm out of the ring and you're in it for this next spot. So let's see what happens next.
Six.
And I roll eight. So.
Cool.
So yeah, you take your breather in, so you're there for a couple of seconds basically, and kind of taking into account that we do have the debris at ringside all over the start of the night. So I'd like you to kind of attempt that you're gonna use something from the debris there. So maybe kind of like a sharp piece of wood or something like that, something that kind of looks okay, that's clearly not gonna be a weapon, but the threat is there. And looks like you're gonna throw it at me, but I'm gonna basically duck and charge you into the kind of remnants of the announcer's table. So and basically go from there. So that'll be you want to treat it as a look roll and see what happens from there. So okay. And that is actually gonna be unsuccessful. So so take it from there. Look, so I kind of gave you some leeway there in terms of what you want to do there. So
so what I want to do then is you're gonna throw me into the corner of the announcer's table, yeah.
I can do that, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to, as you go and throw me, I'm going to stop.
Yep.
So you're basically trying to pull me and I'm not moving.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'll do then is I will, as you're trying to pull me, I'll hold your arm,
get
my head underneath and spine buster you through the announce table.
Yeah. Okay, that works. That'd be parallel as well then for the Wraith.
Oh, fuck. Thanks,
Kieran. Oh, critical spine buster.
You're impaled on the table and you die.
The end.
No, just in red on the Tron, just goes Finn.
Just a classy,
a disastrous die. Finish.
That's good. I like that. So, yeah, proper good old fashioned spine buster onto the rims of the table. And we get our next spot from there, basically. So let's see what happens next.
10.
I roll 4. So this all goes to you, Dave. What would you like to do next?
Cool. So I've just put you through the table.
Yeah.
So what I want is I'll feed you back up, roll you back into the ring.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm going to put you in Hell's Gate. There's a triangle choke.
This is in the middle of the ring, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Grant. I'm going to make that a real roll, so that's plus one.
Okay.
That's an 8, so that's momentum for yourself anyway. And going for submission, I presume, yeah?
Yep.
Never know. So.
That's fine. Get that out of the way now.
Yeah, better off to be that, I suppose. Yeah.
Get that out of the way now.
I couldn't fucking get that if I wanted to, but I actually was in a submission. But fuck that anyway. So, sorry then. So we get to our next spot from there, basically, cool. And see what happens next. So, next spot.
11.
3. So you still have this match under control. So,
what spot are we on?
We've got 3 spots left, including this.
3 spots. So you get out of the submission, you're looking a bit worse for wear. If you feed up into a corner,
mm-hmm.
I will basically go for the cartwheel springboard elbow into the jaw.
Okay.
And get you kind of down onto the mat for a top rope move, should I be successful in the next one. So it's kind of like setting you up for the next spot.
I get you.
The springboard elbow, kind of letting you fall to your knees and then down and roll over. Nothing too extravagant, but like if there's 3 spots left, I don't want to go for the finish too soon.
No, I know what you're going for there. Yeah, that's fair. Okay, I'm going to treat that as a luck roll, which is a minus one to the Wraith. 7, that's enough. So you do hit the springboard elbow, and as we take our next spot, you're going for a top rope move, and I'm on the mat. So let's see what happens next.
Ooh.
3. I roll 9. So, nice. What I like to do actually is, okay, I'm going to take a kind of a page from your own book here. So you're going for a top rope move. And for argument's sake, what were you going to go for?
So I was basically going to go for the leg drop, top rope leg drop.
Top rope leg drop. Okay, yeah, grand.
Matt Hardy style.
Yeah, I know the type. So for argument's sake, I want you to go for it and I'll roll out of the way. That gets you into essentially the middle of the ring.
Okay.
So that gives me an opportunity to go, all right then. And I'm going to go to top rope myself and go for a Swanton Bomb.
Ooh.
Finisher for someone once upon a time.
Don't pull a hammy in the jump.
Careful, indeed. Decker. So, that'd be a straight roll for me. Let's see what happens. And, come on, dice. Okay,
roll into that critical. Come on, thanks.
Oh, here we go. Same guys. I fucked it up. So... this is a weird landing of the dice there. So yeah, it was a botch anyway. So I completely missed the Swanton Bomb then. And we basically get to our next spot from there, essentially. So both top row moves completely fall on their arse. So, right, we get a bit of separation from there and see what happens next.
Oh,
that's more like it. Much better than mine. So yeah, we'll take it from there, basically. So you got your part of this. I've missed the Swanton Bomb. Take it from there, Wraith. What would I
should
do?
Right. Double momentum for this one.
Yeah.
So you're doing the Swanton Bomb. I'm gonna try something a little risky.
Okay.
I don't know if it's possible. No, I don't think it is possible. I was gonna get you to go for the Swanton.
Mm-hmm.
But I was gonna, as your legs come down, I was gonna catch you into a powerbomb. Does that make sense? I mean, as you're coming over.
It can be done. Yeah.
No, as you're coming
could
down,
work, actually, no, that could work anyway, because if I'm stalling with it, if I'm kind of like hesitant about actually hitting it, and yeah, because you're kind of in the middle of the ring, so there's actually theoretical distance. So if I undershoot, you can get back up and basically kind of get into a seated position for it to receive me in the powerbomb. So yeah, that could work. Yeah, so it wouldn't be a power roll as such. That would be a luck roll, because you're essentially making me land in that position. So so luck roll on that and successful. So lovely stuff on that one. Nice spot. Nice spot indeed. Cool. Wraith, you're in the ascendancy here. So what do you want to do here?
This is the finish?
This will be the finish, yeah.
Okay. Does Cutter have a submission finisher?
Yeah,
he has a Katahatame, the Tasmission.
I'm gonna use that on you. After the powerbomb.
Brave man.
To finish it off. Okay. I'm going to use that submission to finish you off, to send a message to that fucking roided bastard in the back.
I like it. I don't really have any strong finishes in mind for mine, to be fair. I was kind of happy enough to lose this match. So...
Oh, don't say that. Don't make it that easy. Jesus.
I know.
You're tainting my victory.
No, I'm not tainting your victory. Shut up the fuck. I think, well, actually, I'll go on for you.
Same thing to me as well. You love tainting everyone's victories.
What? Oh, come on.
You're a victory tainter. But you know why? It's because Decker, never had a fucking proper victory of his own. He wants to make sure he taints everyone else.
I had one against Rob Midas, all right? Get off my back.
That was, do you know what? Jerry even admitted he phoned that in.
He did.
He felt bad for you.
It still counts, damn it.
He felt bad. It was a pity win, and you knew it was a pity win, hence why you tried to taint Oliver.
Yes, that's it. Yeah, I'm trying to steal everyone's thunder. I'm trying to get myself over. Like,
this is why
Jarrett.
Hashtag Decker out technically trended in our group chat. Right.
Yeah, in a group chat. Just
Jonathan,
to be clear, it was a group chat.
It was in the group chat.
I'm going to let you choose your finisher. Right, I'm gonna let you choose to finish this. Right, I've got two ideas for you. The first one was to use Cutter's. I'll leave this to the room. Actually, whatever's more popular.
Oh, this is fun.
Everyone,
mic's on.
I will do Cutter's finisher, which is pretty standard. Send a message, some blah blah blah. Or
you could choose the.
I do
box.
Modified Big Show finish and powerbomb him through the ring in the corner, but afterwards, I light a match, throw the match in, and set the corner on fire.
Oh my God, the fire. I want the fire. That's like a mystery box. Fire. Fire. Yeah, the box.
Bear in mind, I am kind of needed for the pay-per-view, so.
Yeah, I kind of need him for my team, so I'm going to go with the submission.
Oh, yeah. For God. Look, we all know that he's not actually going to. It's very Undertaker in the casket, okay?
It's a visual metaphor.
Read this week's script, for God's sake, James.
Okay, the forced option. Jesus. Fine.
Why do we have to... Oh my God.
Okay, I do actually have a finish in mind, right? So,
okay.
If you're going to go for the cat that had to mate, I'm going to steal someone else's finisher. I'm going to steal Connor Locke's finisher. I'm going to hit you with a Highland Spike.
Fucking hell.
Don't so Jimmy Morrison me, man.
He's either tainting our victories or he's Jimmy Morrison up the show. There we go, guys.
I don't know which is more insulting, to be honest.
Yeah.
The fact that he's actually taking a page Jimmy Morrison's book.
That's sad. Times are tough, lads. We're all getting the bus home.
I don't appreciate that one.
No, that's fair.
Right. Are the momentum counts?
Momentum. So Decker is sitting on 5 momentum while the Wraith is sitting comfortably on 9. There's a 4-point swing on it. So I'll take the pace for plus 5. And again, I fancy your chances, Dave. Plus 10 altogether to beat. So okay. I think actually you're home and host. You should be able to. Yeah, no. You're grand. So my role was good in the either way. So again, you lock in the cat that had to mate. And take it away from here.
So I lock in the submission. You tap out. I'm not letting go.
Mm-hmm.
I'm continuing to do it against James Rage's best wishes. I'm holding into the submission. It takes 2 referees to kind of break me off it. Mm. And with that, hopefully Cutter was watching that match, because that was a direct message to him and saying, like, this guy ran the company. This guy, you know, was the head honcho. Now he's just lying in the ring at my feet. Yeah. You know, it's going to take him.
He will understand, considering he did set me on fire. So, you know, he understands the struggle. So. Yep.
God, I do love a bit of fun.
And then kind of just basically sitting in the corner, sitting in one of the corners, my arms on my knees, and then it just kind of goes dark, goes back up on light, and I'm gone.
See you later. Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. And the commentators will go from there on. Well, like I said, the race takes another win here in Future Wrestling as he heads toward this Battle of the Monsters against Cutter. And that even when he says that, you just hear that's the same guttural hell we heard earlier on going. And if I could hazard a guess, I'd say that Cutter was watching that match attentively, and fair to say might be actually looking forward to this match with the Wraith, whatever shape it actually takes. So we go from there. Right, and so...
I'd be happy
if you murdered Kyle Decker. Can I just point out that Cutter is on the other team? Team Future.
Yeah.
Do it, right?
Hey. if you want to, you can take the captain's spot.
I think Downfall is the perfect place to retire this alter ego stuff.
It is. That's fair. It's
I've missed that Scottish bastard. It's not fair.
We all do, Dave.
I know how you feel when you suddenly have to go to a different character. You're like... Shit, I actually missed my first child, okay? And I want them.
You're my favorite. Okay, I changed my mind. You're my favorite.
It is actually generally amazing how quickly you realize, shit, you do actually form an attachment to your NPCs.
It's true. It is very true.
Yep.
So when we come back, then it's time for the main event. So what we're going to see is a camera catch Violet Storm on her way to basically Gorilla. Want of a better word. So she's holding the world championship over her shoulder, and as she stopped, she's going to stop walking for a brief moment, and when she does, the camera pans out to see James Rage waiting also at Gorilla, because they're on the same team tonight. So whoever wants to kind of start off the promo, guys, take it away.
Rage, ready for this?
Sorry, go again.
Yeah, no, it's okay. She started
from the top.
Yeah.
Oh, it's all I did. All I said was Rage anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Violet, fancy seeing you here.
Fucking
looks
that.
Like tonight. Looks like tonight you and I team up once again, undefeated as we are as a team, and we take on the longest reigning tag team champions in the history of this promotion. But we already know it's a washout. You see, you and I are going to go out there and we're going to show those turncoat pricks exactly what Future of Wrestling is all about, much like we're going to do at Downfall. Because you see, I think Mike Dublin put it best earlier when he said that at Downfall Night 1, you've got a speed bump in Cyrus Gold, because let's be fair, he doesn't amount to much more than that. And for that reason, I look forward to seeing you on Night 2 at 100%. And for that reason, you know, you have nothing to worry about tonight, because you see, I'm sure Fred's got his games. I'm sure he's going to try and play him. But if he does, I assure you, I've got your back.
Okay, I'll take you at your word. And believe me, yeah, Cyrus is going to bulldoze through that speed ramp, because I'm looking forward to our match. You just make sure that the Future team absolutely annihilates the bureaucrats on the other side.
You see, the bureaucrats, they didn't know what they were doing when they picked this fight. And that will be their downfall, fittingly enough. But you see, what's going to happen there is I'm going to lead Team Future Wrestling. But I'm not just going to lead them in that match, Violet. You see, I'm going to lead them into war. We are going to leave the other side devastated. And then I am going to take that title and I am going to take my rightful place as the permanent leader of Future Wrestling. Now, make no mistake, that's not to denigrate you. That's not to say that you're not talented, because you clearly, clearly are. And that is why I need you at 100% on Night 2. I need that moment to be everything that it can be. So I say, you and I, we go out there tonight. We show Kaziro and Vlad exactly what Future Wrestling's all about. Night 1 of Downfall, we put an end to the VCR Network's influence over this promotion. And then on Night 2, we start the new era right there in that ring.
Show them the true meaning of independent. Absolutely. But you'll definitely have a fight in your hands to get this title out of it.
I wouldn't have it any other way.
Right. Let's go show these two who's boss.
Very good. Lovely stuff, lads. Lovely stuff. So I'm going to give both of you +2 on your rolls to see if you get some momentum and or audiences from that. So let's see how they play out.
I played out as my dice, it would help.
I got random.org's cookie policy.
That doesn't count. You got momentum to start your match off anyway. And let's see if Wallace Storm gets the same. And she does, nearly an audience at that. So lovely stuff there. And indeed, we get to our main event from here. So as you guys were talking, we could hear the Emperor's theme music from there. So when that happens, then we hear the ring announcer going, "Ladies and gentlemen, this next contest is your main event of the evening, and it is a tag team match. Introducing first, weighing in at a combined weight of 517 pounds, the team of the Dragon Slayer Kaziro and Vladimir Kaiser, the Emperors." Well, folks, you've heard the words of the two, I suppose, the protagonists of Night 2, if you will, in James Drake and Violet Storm. But as of right now, they have to be on the same page. If they're going to win tonight against the Emperors, as you've heard from Rage earlier on, a formidable tag team in their own right with the prestige to prove it. It seems going by all rumblings backstage, they have chosen their side, and it is on the network's perspective rather than Future Wrestling. But shouldn't expect any more from these mercenaries here in the ring. They are looking for just another win here in that regard. So when that happens, then we are going to get our entrances then. So first out then will be James Rage. And introducing their opponents, weighing in at 241 pounds, hailing from the Asylum Fight Camp, James Rage.
Yeah. So yeah, much the same, just here to do business. Come out on the ramp, walk about halfway down it, kind of, you know, checking all the angles because, you know, Frankie Baby is in the building. So I chill about halfway down and I wait.
Indeed. And as you wait then, we hear the music of your tag team partner. And his partner, weighing in at 190 pounds from Dublin, Ireland, she is the future world champion, Violet Storm! So here, talk about your entrance.
So, come out and pretty much just join James Rage again, keeping her head on a bit of a swivel. make sure there's nothing, no surprises lurking around, but it's all business.
Indeed, and again, we get a kind of bit of a square off, and then you either go separate ways or go to the same corner, whichever suits you best. But either way, yeah, this match is going to get underway. So Jamie,
before the bell rings, can I shake Violet's hand?
Okay. Or
extend a handshake at least.
Mm-hmm.
Violet will accept it.
All right then. Okay then. So in that case then, yeah. So we're gonna get the bell's gonna ring. We are gonna have 10 spots for this main event. So I'm gonna have Kazero start off for the Emperors. Jamie, Kira, who would like to start off for your match?
I'll go.
Yeah, Jamie's gonna start. Okay then. So this is between Rage and Kazero. So let's see who begins.
Q. That's a 9.
And 10. Okay, so gonna keep it simple with a collar and elbow to start off with. And collar and elbow, run the ropes, do the usual kind of trimmings for a fairly slow paced start to the match. And then essentially as you're kind of bouncing back off the ropes, I want Kazero to basically hit you with a real quick drop kick to bring it down to the mat. So that'll be a luck roll for Kazero, which is a +1. And that is enough for Kazero to get across the line. So that's momentum for the Empress. And we take it from there. So so Kazero's going to be staying in for this one. Jamie, will you be doing the same? Yeah. Oh, well, certainly with that roll, certainly beats Kazero. So how do you respond to the drop kick, Jamie?
So I take the drop kick, get back up fairly quickly, kind of walk it off, sort of like, oh, there, fucker. walk over to the neutral corner, walk over to my corner, make it look like I'm going to tag Violet, put out the hand as though to tag. And then as Kazero's coming over, I wear a chop off his chest. I slap the taste out of his mouth. There we go.
That's even worse. My God, that's even worse. That's a real roll, James Rage.
Yeah.
Honestly, God. Right. Bam. And yeah, we can hear the sound from here. So nasty impact for Uncle Zero there. And yeah, so we take control over there. Naturally, Kazero is going to be staying in for this one. So Rage, are you doing the same?
Yeah. I'm right. Hoping to follow through on that slap.
Fabulous. So let's see who wins out.
8-10.
So we have the 10 here. So so Kazero's not gonna respond too kindly to the slap. But I want you to kind of continue on with that sort of barrage. So you're gonna go for chops in the corner. Kazero will kind of duck out and deliver a few himself and essentially go for a running knee in the corner as basically a spring shot. So running in the corner, so that'll be a look roll for him, which is +1 again. And he gets you with that as well. So that's actually critical. He gets you really flush on the chin. So you probably get the snap back on it there, and it looks pretty nasty from the camera shot. So Kazero will go for pinfall. You'll kick out, and he's going to tag out to Kaiser. So Kaiser's going to come in for this. Ray, are you going to take a tag or?
Yeah, I think so. Right. If Violet's up for it.
Fair enough.
Seems like a natural.
natural break, yeah, that's fair. Daddy, right, so we get to our next one from here then. So it's between Kaiser and Violet Storm. So let's see who wins out.
Dude.
That's seven. Just beat by six. So Violet Storm takes the spot. What would you like to do?
Okay, so it's, where is Kazero?
Kazero has rolled out as tagged out to Kaiser here, so he's in the apartment. Yeah.
Why do we always get put up against them and I can never distinguish between the two of them?
It's the K's. I know. It's confusing. Anyway, so Kaiser's coming, approaching you here, and he's obviously angling for a move here. So,
okay, so he's approaching from his corner, and I want to hop into the ring, run the rope, and go for the drop toe into the figure four.
Grant, that'll be a work roll for you, Violet Storm, plus two. And that is a 10 altogether. So that's a good snug figure four for Kaiser to trouble his head out of. It's a positive roll, so he'll be in it for a while, and then he'll grab the rope from there. So good momentum for Violet Storm, though, and Kaiser's going to stay in for this next spot. So Violet Storm, would you be doing the same?
Yeah.
Grant, so let's see who wins it. That's a 10, and that beats my 5. So you take it away here, Violet Storm. What would you like to do next?
Okay. So I... I'm trying to think here. So feedback up. Run the ropes and go for a standing drop to the knees.
Drop to the knees. Okay, Grant. Yeah.
I'm right. These guys are nearly 6 foot, yeah?
Oh, yeah. No, they're significantly taller. So, yeah, yeah. You're kind of focusing on limb there. So I'll treat that as a straight roll for you then. So straight roll for a Violet Storm. And that's successful. So you do, you get him down to a significantly shorter base, fair to say, with that. And he's down to his knee, and we take it from there. So I will have Kaiser staying in for this one, but Vala, are you staying in?
Yes.
Right then. So let's see who wins this role. So that is a 8. That beats my 5. So you are still in control of the match, Violet. What would you like to do next?
Okay, so when he's essentially down to one knee, I'm trying to think of what the name of the move is. It's not coming to me.
How does it sound?
No, it's you want to use the stand and the leg that's not down, like to use it as a step up on it.
Oh, the tripod. Oh, and
Stunning Wizard.
Yeah. No, or no, no, Stunning
Wizard. The one like the Loki used to do.
Into like an Insiguri or
no? No, see, this it's not coming, so I'll pick something else. Because okay. I'll find it later and I'll put it into the chat. that's what it so you know, he's down on one knee and he has the knee in front of him, so use the knee that's in front of him to kind of step up, use the momentum up, and then axe kick to the back of the neck.
Kind of scorpion kick, yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Ah, yeah, that's it. Back. Yes.
How do I describe this?
That's fair. Yeah, straight roll again, and for Violet Storm on that then. So we're going to treat that as a reel. And that is successful. So you do get momentum out of it, and we continue the match from there. So so Kaiser's going to be still in the ring from this one. Violet, are you staying in?
How many spots are left?
4 spots.
I'll tag Jamie back in.
Okay, then. So this is between Rage and Kaiser. Yeah. So let's see what happens here.
Perfect. I need a phone. I'm a 9.
9? 10. So So what I'll do is when Volstorm tags in then, tags out rather, so Ray's going to come in, he's going to feed Kaiser up to his feet because he's going to perhaps look for a power move, I'm not too sure. Maybe something like a suplex or something fireman's carry oriented. But what I want to do is want Kaiser to kind of come out from the shoulders here and I want to hit him with a nice big backbreaker over his knee. So that'll be a rear roll for Kaiser, which is significantly bigger. And he's going to hit it. Excuse me. That was an 11 altogether. That makes the critical backbreaker at that. So, because he had the plus two on it. So he gets the momentum for that. And again, looks pretty nasty. He's going to tag Kazero in here. So we're back to Rage versus Kazero for the next spot, I presume. Are you staying in for this one, Jamie?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So in that case then, yeah. So I have Kazero roll for him. So let's see what happens next. Okay. That is a 10 and that beats by 9. So you take control here after the backbreaker.
Okay. But 'twas critical.
Yes. So you will definitely be selling it, put it that way.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think I might go for my match objective here. I've got a bit of a spot, if that's okay.
If you have a spot, by all means, go for it.
Okay, so he comes in, I'm just after taking the backbreaker, so he takes me to the corner.
Mm-hmm.
Bit of a scuffle. Kaiser is charging over to try and catch us from behind. I mean, with Kazero, right?
Yeah, Kazero's tied Kaiser in here, so he's legal man,
perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect. I get the advantage, actually. I put him on the top rope as if to go for a superplex. Yeah. Kaiser tries to sandwich me from behind. I get out of the way. They collide. I put Kaiser up on the middle rope while Kazero's sitting on the top rope. Climb up behind Kaiser, hook them into a superplex, and then German suplex Kaiser and Kazero.
Oh, I like it. Like an avalanche superplex. I like it. Yeah.
I'll Man Terror Doom.
Man Terror, absolutely, yes. And I'll treat that as a power roll. So that'd be a plus one to you, Jamie. Oh, nearly critical too. Nearly critical. But yeah, definitely exactly what you want there. And fair to say, Wildstorm looked quite impressed with that feat of strength. Okay, that is your match objective, so nicely done there. All right, so Kazero is still the legal man here. Obviously, Kaiser's in the ring, but he will roll out accordingly. So are you staying in for this one, Jamie, or are you tagging in for Wildstorm?
I am going to stay in. We're down to how many spots?
Two spots left before the finish.
How much momentum do I have?
You currently have 4.
Oh, fuck, that's not as much as I thought. Oh, fuck, this is the go-home. Right, yeah, no, we're saving up. Okay. Well, John, you're over to finish. I'm going to stay in, though, for the rolling sake. Yeah, that's...
You want to stay in for the time being? Yeah. Okay, fair enough. All right. In that case, let's see what happens next, in that sense. So, I roll 8 for Kazero. And that's 9. So you do get the roll here. So what does he do next?
Okay, so Kazero got superplexed. So he's down. Kaiser is rolled out. He's far away. Yeah, sure. Let's say we did that in their corner. He's getting up. And I take off and shotgun drop kick him into my corner.
Nice. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, cool. I'll treat that as a luck roll. So that'd be straight roll for James Rage.
Sweet.
That is successful. So you do get the momentum out of it. Kazero is now in your corner. And we have one spot before the finish. So Kazero is in no man's land here. So he's staying in. What's happening between you two? Is Rage staying in or is Wallace tagging in?
What's my momentum count at right now?
5.
I would like 6, but yeah, fuck it. What does Violet Storm do off the top rope?
Moonsault.
Okay. You should know you landed one a couple of weeks ago.
That is true. That is true. You're fairly zippy though, right?
That'd be one way of describing it, yeah.
What if we were to set up where I electric chair him and you ran at them off my shoulders?
Oh, I like that. I like that.
Doomsday Rana, baby.
Yeah, I like that. Okay, I will treat that as a luck roll for the two of you. So let's call it a straight roll for that then. Straight roll for that spot.
I'm not sure who's meant to roll.
But... Well, if that's the case, and so if you're tagging, are you tagging in, Jamie?
I'll give that.
Yeah. Okay, and sure, Violet, then let's see if your roll works.
Yeah.
It's double team after all.
Yeah, hold on 1 sec.
That works fine. So you do, you get the momentum out of it either way. So lovely stuff there. So, all right then. So that leads us to our finish quite nicely. So, as things stand, we've had that electric chair spot there. So, Kaiser is going to come in as the unlegal man here and try and basically deflect away some attention off Kaiser. But at the moment, Volastorm, you are the legal person, I believe. You're tagged in. Am I right in saying, Jim?
Yep.
Brand? So in that case, you could potentially take this home. So what would you like to do?
Okay, so the one we've just run into is the legal one, right?
Kaiser, the one you ran, he is legal. Okay. Kaiser is in play, however. So
okay, so I would suggest this is the final spot.
This is the finish. Okay. This is the finish. Yeah.
That rage would go for Kaiser, and take him out in his inimitable style.
Yes.
And my suggestion for finish will be before Zero gets up, go for a double stomp and then pull him into an armbar.
Oh, okay. So you want to go for the armbar finish here, right? That's fair enough. So for the Emperor's, Kaiser will obviously get distracted by rage. That'll be one aspect of it. Kaiser will obviously be in the ring with Violet Storm. So I essentially want the a tap out to occur, but the referee is essentially distracted by the stuff that's happening between Rage and Kaiser, and essentially he misses the tap out. So Volastorm will let go. It's a confusion in between you two essentially, and it's essentially the fact that the Emperors are going to take advantage of it and go for a cheap win from there. So they'll probably use the world title match or the world title belt that's there and use that as interference and basically go for a finish from there. So, in that regard, the Emperors currently sit on 6 momentum, whereas Volastorm and James Rage sit on a combined 12. Mm-hmm. So, it's actually 6 each as we stand. So, obviously, the Emperors are going to stand on, going to throw this into as a +6 roll. Volastorm, are you throwing your momentum in here as well?
Yeah.
And James Rage, are you throwing your momentum in here?
Oh, you can bloody well catch it.
Yes, this is his move.
God about that. Move.
Yeah,
big so kick. Did I.
So, this of course locks out his audience stats. We can't advance or anything like that. So he's keeping the momentum for the goal for the two-nighter, bear in mind. So that momentum does you for both nights, just to keep that in mind.
Yep.
So, with that being said then, this is a straight 6 roll between myself and Kira. So, I'll set the pace. 13 to beat.
Lovely. Okay, so
you beat it by 1.
Cha-ching!
You beat it by 1.
Thank you,
the skin of the proverbial teeth, and James Rage gets to keep his momentum guilt free. So with that, Kit, So yeah, we get that little bit of that moment between Kaiser and Rage that gets them out of commission essentially for the finish.
Can I
stand up.
Can I Biggie spear him off the apron?
You can absolutely Biggie spear him off the apron, 100%.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Get your neck and you're doing it all, please, because we need you for the season finale. No
belly to belly suplexes. It's fine.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So with that then, that leaves Vada Storm to take it home with Kazero. So talk us through again.
So before he gets up from the Rana, mm-hmm. Basically run the rope, do a double stomp, and basically maneuver him into an armbar, stop bang in the middle of the ring.
And just for that to kind of delightful little spot there, easy James Rage at ringside, make the eye contact. Yeah.
Oh, I've got something for the post match, just real quick, if that's okay.
Okay.
But I think that sounds really seamless, where she gets the Rana out of the electric chair. She goes to the top. Kaiser gets on the apron to push her off. I spear him to the ground. She connects with the double stomp, armbar, finish.
Beautiful.
And if it's possible once the match is over.
I can call for the ring announcer here. Ladies and gentlemen, your winner by submission, the team of Vada Storm and James Rage.
I would like to slide into the ring behind her carrying the future world championship and tease that I'm about to crease her with it and then hand it over because I'll be taking it soon enough.
Bring it on.
Just to give it to you and to shake your hand and be like, yeah, we did that. Thank you. And then whatever else happened.
Lovely stuff. And Kira, have you any replies to that?
So is Rage then heading to the back?
He can be.
So just as he's walking away, while it stands in the middle of the ring, from Raven's tie shows off her head.
Indeed, and the commentators are going there. Well, I think this is all it's all about in the end, folks. Regardless of what happens to this show, that world title means everything to those two competitors, to the champion at the moment, and the person who has spent a good word of these 2 years chasing that as validation for him believing he is the top dog. And if he does win the championship at Downfall, that'll be confirmation that he is. But look at who he has to go through at the end, because Vada Storm has denied all challengers so far, and it's just going to be the case that can James Rage go against the grain and win that world championship against Violet Storm. So as he's about to sign off for the night then, I'm going to ask all of you, namely Foxy, Jamie, Amy, and Kira, for roles, because we're going to do a SmackDown finish to end our season. So I have rolled for our two NPCs here, which is Wayne and Cutter. So it's just basically to see what the sequence of this is going to be. So, okay, that's an 11. That's interesting. Let's see. That's a 9. Okay. Foxy, how about yourself?
I get this earlier.
That's 12. Okay, that's actually quite interesting too. Amy, can you give us a quick roll there?
Amy.
Camera is in aha mode. Aha!
No, I can't because my internet's gone to shit.
Oh dear!
I think it's gonna crash again. Yeah.
Oh dear.
Yeah, I can't do anything.
That's a pity.
Will I roll for you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Fuck it. Go ahead.
Okay, so this will be Casey's.
Amy, you're moving. We can see you. It's.
I know.
Yeah, but I can't. I actually legit can't even roll my fucking dice. My internet is actually gone, and I'm doing it off the phone. Like, so.
There you go. You got an 11.
Okay.
And go back to the old one. Okay. There we go.
All right. Right. So. Sorry. Just bear with me 2 minutes. I'm going to work out the sequence here. So. Okay. So I worked out a bit of a sequence here. So we're gonna. We're going to have six people involved in this. Well, not technically all six, but we're going to see people kind of coming in to do finishers here. So, so Ray, you're coming up the ramp here at the moment as we speak. Am I right in saying?
Yep, that sounds right. I'd have my back.
Sounds good.
conveniently to the entranceway, staring down old Violet there as she holds up the championship victorious.
Beautiful. Right. So what's going to happen here is then, as Storm is celebrating, she's going to get blindsided by Wayne Kyle.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Have I been Pearl Harbored again? Why is it always me?
No, not from the front.
Not from... You will turn around as he hits you with the discus elbow, the bullhammer elbow. So he clocks you with that then, and he starts beating down with you there. So obviously Rage is kind of going like Rage is looking like, okay, what the fuck's going on here? I'm gonna start coming to help basically. Whereas Wayne stands Storm up. Storm's gonna start fighting back against Wayne.
It's fucking Wayne.
Yeah.
Oh, it's more than a consideration on whether I'm coming back.
Yeah.
She best get the... Oh, sorry.
Yeah. No. You're right. What you're saying, but we have the sequence work out here. So as you're running down to the ring, you're at the apron now at this stage, but Violet Storm is going to fight back against Wayne. So Violet Storm,
which is...
okay.
You are going to get a free swing here on Wayne. So how are you going to fight back?
So what? He's hit me with the discus elbow.
Yes.
Fucking spear.
And you're going to spear him. Nice. So you're going to spear him down so far like that, Grant.
Yeah, and just start wailing if I can.
Bite. And start wailing if he can. Steal his pants.
Yeah, exactly. So he's going to roll out from there, basically. It looks like kind of Storm has got the ring back to herself there. And this is when next person in the queue then is going to be Casey Colt.
I don't know what's happening. Rolls.
So basically, we're basically hitting finishes on each other to end the show. So Storm has hit a spear on Wayne. Wayne's gone. So Casey can come in here and now hit a move on Storm.
Okay. It can be any move.
Any move, mm-hmm. Whichever, yeah. Just it's like a finisher rush, basically.
Oh, fuck it then. I'll just hit her with a bulldog. There's no point. There's too much effort in my finisher, so just hit her with a bulldog. Unprettier, actually. Yeah.
Unprettier. Perfect. Yeah, because then you can't catch her on the blind side from that. Then so Casey hits Violet Storm with an unprettier, and
fuck me.
That must have been a really fucking good unprettier. Holy shit!
That second one, Kira. Fuck. Fuck. There was two unprettiers. Fuck.
Damn, that's some fucking unprettier.
That's it, I tell you. At last, she's on her own.
I hope someone bought her dinner.
Yeah, apparently you can see it if you just close your eyes. Right, so next up in the queue then is going to be James Rage. This is where you come fantastic. In then to hit a move on Casey Colt. Free swing, what would you like to do here after she hits by the storm with an unprettier?
Okay, so Kyle elbow, she spears, I'm prettier.
Mm-hmm.
Back in, she's up, she turns around. Yeah, things are getting crowded. She charges me. I duck, she hits the corner, and I catch her with a... Yeah, I duck. She hits the corner. I'm already after taking off to the other side. As I come back, I catch her with the boot over the ropes.
Boot over the ropes. That keeps her out of the ring then.
I actually would have thought an RKO would have been perfect, as Casey is just like, ha, 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 and then she just walks into an RKO.
Nice.
Yeah. Someone do that to Cutter. Someone do that to fucking James Rage, please.
Actually... Yeah, no, forget the boot. She gets up from the unprettier. She has her back to me. I rack her up and burning hammer her out of the ring over the ropes.
Oh,
that's okay. Yeah, that's pretty good. Okay.
That is the fucking correct answer. Yeah, exactly. So you're jaw-jacking with Casey as you're doing that. And as when you turn around, straight up, here's Cutter, massive choke on the middle of the ring. And he starts then looking, motion to do the same with Violet Storm. She's up at this stage. And this is when the reinforcements arrive. You're seeing the faces come out, the heels are going to come out, and they start having that clash again, as we've seen in the previous few weeks. So they're clashing away. There's a few of them in the ring. That gets Cutter basically down to a stage where he lets go of Violet Storm. They start hacking away at him in particular, because again, he's kind of the biggest threat of the lot. A couple of kind of like NPCs kind of come in to help out, the likes of your Jack Freedoms, your Cal Pierce. They start taking him down a little bit to the point where he is on the mat. And we end the sequence with Silver Fox, who was taken to the top rope, and he ended on a high. Silver Fox, what would you like to do?
It's on what, Cutter, is it?
On Cutter, yeah.
Burn him.
Is this literally the end of the season on television?
This is the end of the season on television, yes.
And Silver Fox is about to do the final thing that we see in season two of Future Wrestling.
Yes, terms of a wrestling move, yes.
Is there any scope for the brawl to have moved to the ramp / stage area?
Mm-hmm. Oh my god, do you want us to Jim Duggan it?
Onto everyone.
Oh, that works. Yeah,
brawl to the back while fucking Silver Fox torpedoes all over the top rope onto everyone.
I thought he was going to Tron dive, actually.
That's what I think he was going to.
A great way to actually finish out the show. Literally just a visual of him jumping, doll down, end show. There you go.
Boom.
There you go.
I think that works, doesn't it? Yeah. So we'll have the scrum looking like, again, so we can get people kind of like ushering the brawl out. Cutter still hitting people. They're hitting Cutter. You'll have everyone involved, mixed in, like your Casey's Rage. Everyone's in this big scrum to the point where it's getting hushed out of the head on off the stage, essentially. Again, it's not the biggest stage in the world. It's an area where people can land. And you'll just see, again, top right of the camera, you'll see a rush of Silver and Fox. You're obviously going to take a massive dive onto everyone that's there. And it just wipes everybody out, and you get the visual of everyone just like kind of completely neutralized from there. Mm. And it's just even the visual of like of like Rose just like on his own going, what the fuck, what the hell is going on, type of shit. So it's just like just the anarchy is taking over at this stage, and the Mike Dublin's gonna take it home from there, going like, look folks, we're completely out of time here. If this is the end of Future Wrestling, what hell of a way to end it. I've been Mike Dublin. Thank you very much for watching us this entire season. I hope you can join us next week for Downfall 2 Night Special. Don't not forget to tune in for both Night 1 and Night 2. It promises to be a hell of a weekend of wrestling, whatever happens. But folks, we'll see you then next time. We may never see you next time. This could be it for Future Wrestling. But tune into Downfall to see whatever happens next for us. We'll see you sometime down the line. I've been Mike Dublin. Good night, everybody. It is about graveyards. It can be the height of summer and there's still a chill hanging around. Always so quiet too. Peaceful. Well, at least today it is. Long time no see, Lee. Sorry it took me so long. I guess 3 years is a long time, isn't it? Although, I'm sure you'd prefer to be longer. Don't blame you. But I'm here now. I've got a rare day off. And so I'm spending it with my family. Or rather, standing here talking to a stone that won't talk back. I know you'd have preferred a nice big plaque, but that's not a luxury that neither of us are going to get, is it? Anyway, I didn't bring flowers. Not really our style, is it? So, brought you your favorite. You know, I know I've said it countless times, but I've no idea what you see in this stuff. It tastes awful, cheap as shit. And yet here I am, can in hand like the good old days. It's you, brother. I'll leave this one here. Fancy something. You know, I'd like to think you've been curious about how I've been doing. Well, since that night I've had these dreams. Well, nightmares, really. They're not reoccurring or anything like that. But they're always about the past. About what we were before we became wrestlers and escaped it all. So, on my way here, I thought I'd drop off at the old school. I remembered how much you hated it. I kept myself to myself, though. Not wanting to share anything with anyone. Didn't really matter, did it? Our reputation preceded us. You can't really live a normal life when every teacher and every parent looks at you differently. Adam and Lee. The Collins boys. Fucking name. It was a curse. Well, it was for me anyway. I was ashamed of it. Even though we had everything we ever wanted. Newest games, brand new trainers every week, even phones. Every kid in the playground jealous of how much we had. You loved it, of course. Why wouldn't you? Being the popular kid with everything that they ever needed. It's intoxicating. It's like your dad being Santa Claus. But he wasn't. He was Old Whacker. A name that every drug runner from here to the north is scared shitless of. And here we were trying to be kids. And all the while being showered with gifts. I knew where it all came from though. Couldn't live with that knowledge. In a way, I understand now why you might have always resented me. I hope you understand that because I was the elder brother, I saw things you didn't. How he bought us these big stereos so we'd play our music as loud as we wanted. But he did it so he could get to work down the kitchen on whatever poor fucker crossed him. Of course, the worker didn't care that I saw it. He just accepted that I'd find out eventually. We're the heirs to the throne, after all. That was until we ran away from home. We hid at Aunt Mara's. She took us in, knowing what would happen to us if she didn't. I hated who we were. Who we were meant to become. But you embraced him. Maybe that was the start. You want to acknowledge your roots, whereas I wanted to forget them, forge my own path, and make my own name. A life that wasn't soaked in blood money or stepping on the backs of others. You know, every now and then I come back to a memory I have of us back in our old home, how we'd watch everything together. Old Japanese cartoons, sitcoms, horror movies, the lot. We always went back to wrestling. There was something magical about it. You get to be the hero yourself, or the villain. You always loved these dangerous matches, broken tables, chair shots. Whereas I studied the wrestling, ready to tell the story beat by beat. You thought it was boring. You could never understand what I saw in it. I think you're about 11 or 12, and you said to me that your wish was to work in a wrestling show where there are no bad guys. Even now, I still laugh at that. That was how you saw the world, wasn't it, Lee? Everything was black and white, a yes or a no. In a way, I admired it. That innocence shielded you from a lot of our childhood. I didn't have that luxury, nor did I want it. No matter what, I still keep coming back to what you said then. It's never left my mind, even when we are at each other's throats. After all, everyone's entitled to their dream. It's what I wanted too. But it was more than that. I wanted a wrestling show that was bigger than the sum of its parts. Everyone has their talents and skills, but when they're all together, it becomes example,
standard for everyone else to follow. Lofty ambitions. 40 something we couldn't achieve together. You know, I'll never forgive myself for how that night went. I was tired. I was frustrated. Playing the big brother, parenting the younger sibling, wanted to be the free spirit while everyone else had to work around it. I felt like I needed a turn. Maybe it's the years of hindsight that that little bit of patience could have meant both of us were here now, reminiscing as if it was ancient history. Maybe I pressed the wrong buttons, may set you off in a spiral that you couldn't come back from. Even with all your problems, your issues, and your habits that you tried to kick, I still worried about you. Because I wanted you to get better. I wanted you to be the best version of yourself, like I demanded of me. I always feared that you'd go back to Wacker and end up being one of his sacrificial lambs. You were more than that. And yet, I never once said that to you when you were alive. Another one of my regrets. You know, I still can't remember what happened that moment. I couldn't think of anything else but the pain. I just remember looking at your face when I went off. And how everything went so silent after that. I was gone. In that moment, I was convinced I was dead. In a way, I wish I was. Because I still have to continue. Continue on knowing that I may have killed the only family I ever had. And we'll never know the truth. Because of what Tony did. Wiped the crime scene clean, took the weapons for himself, left me at a hospital with no explanation, and what he did to you was unforgivable. Having to tell every single person this lie, eating me every single day. I wish I could just scream the truth out for everyone to hear, but I know I can't. In a way, I'm grateful for Tony to give me the second chance to make something better of what came before. But I also hate him. Because I can't achieve that closure that I want. That we deserve. It's not fair that you'll always have that doubt cast about you. And the first piece of shit I call a father even cared the slightest. What would he do? Just pin the blame on someone else and the cycle of violence continues. You know, I couldn't even mourn your death. I wasn't able to arrange a funeral. You just had to fade away as if you were just another victim of a gang war. A name to be thrown around as if it meant nothing. It's not fair. We never asked for the life we were born into. That's why we ran away, Lee. I didn't want you, I want us to be just a footnote in a rag, saying how we'd run drugs for our dad or be targets constantly on the run. In my head, even then, I wanted us to avoid this early grave, and yet after all that, I'm alive and you're not. All could have been avoided. Ever since then, I just wanted your life to matter. Maybe it's guilt, maybe it's grief. But that's what's fueled me over the last few years. To build something that we could both call home. And so, here comes Future Wrestling. Catching up for a network to pick us up, but of course that comes at its own price. The last 2 years have been crazy. Spend so much time fighting politics from people who just want their own power fantasy, think they can use us in their own little games, and all the while I'm trying to run a show on occasion, wrestle a few matches. And I say that itch never goes away, but it's not about me. Never was. I know my fate is to fade into obscurity. That's why I want my legacy to be that show. I'll defend it with my life. But I'm tired, Lee. It's been two very long years. Any respite from the hounds I've relished, enjoyed those good times while they lasted. We've gone on tours around Europe. We even set up a wrestler's court just for fun. For some time, that's all it was. I know I'm detached from the rest of the roster, but I can't let anyone close to me. I don't want to take them down with me. A good friend asked me a long time ago for the truth. I'm sure you wouldn't mind me saying it in complete confidence. After all that, she asked me, why am I still here? Why bother building something you might end up destroying yourself? Admittedly, she had a point. I mulled over that for a long time, always in the back of my mind of what to do next. How to preserve the work we've done. And as we were making those plans, the hounds came back. And they've got the knives to our throats. Come to think of it, you'd love all the drama. The uncertainty, the blurred lines. How it's all playing out live in front of the eyes of the wider world. We've dragged out the monsters out into the light. But they still might win. Nothing's guaranteed. But what we've done has brought everyone together. We're all fighting the same fight. They say we're dead and buried and tomorrow is just a swan song. Go out with a bang, isn't that what they say? But I won't let our dream die here and now. There's too many people, too many good people that deserve more. I hope it's not over. We've got one last ace in the hole. One final throw of the dice. All decides the future. I wish you were here for it. I wish you could see it all taking shape and how it's going to be the pride of the industry. You know, I don't know where we end up when we're dead. Whether there is a heaven or a hell, whether a god's up there pulling strings. And despite Anne Moore's best efforts, I won't be lighting any candles to ask for help. It's not for me. And even then, I wouldn't be welcome after what I've done. But even if you can't be here in the flesh, well, I found another way. You call them primal. I call them the Wraith. The character you wanted to give life to, I've done it for you. I picked someone who I knew would do it justice and carry it with pride. You'll never know where it came from. For me, it's an apology for everything. I took this away from you, one way or another. So this is at least one way of bringing you back. Some way to have you here with us. You know, I don't know why it took me so long to say all of this. Maybe because I couldn't admit to myself what I've done. Except that no matter how it happened, it still did. That pain will stay forever. That loss will always be there. You're not suddenly going to appear and tell me everything is alright. It was just all a crazy dream and that everything's forgiven. I don't know if you would forgive me. I can only fool myself into thinking so. But either way, the past is the past. And as much as it hurts, I can use it. Make something out of it. Lee, you will always be here with me. No matter what happens, I will never forget you. I won't let anyone forget you. Because that wild-eyed dream of a naive, innocent kid I call the little brother is going to happen. It's going to come true. A world where there are no bad guys. All the bad apples found, discarded, never to be seen again. No more politics, no more conspiracies, no more bullying, no more abuse. Somewhere that everyone is free to live their dream, no matter how unlikely it sounds. Where people deserve the success for who they are, for being good people. Somewhere that we can all go to, be our little sanctuary. That childlike wonder never really goes away. fact, it becomes our job. One way or another, this weekend is for you, Lee. I hope you're there. I hope you see us all win. I hope you know the future we've made of ourselves. Something that no one, not even old Whacker, can take away from us. Somewhere that we can be free to be ourselves. Our true selves. Goodbye, Lee. You were my brother. And I love you. I always have. And I always will. Here's to the future. Whatever it may bring.